Good evening. It's 6:30, June 13, 2016. I'd like to call the Planning and Zoning Commission meeting to order. Could I have the roll, please?
Mr. Robinson?
Here.
Mr. Walker?
Here.
Mr. Sporhees?
Here.
Mr. Kange?
Present.
Mr. Spinelli?
Here.
Ms. Bailey?
Here.
Ms. Barker?
Here.
Mr. Strike?
Here.
Mr. Spring has been excused. Thank you.
Thank you. Could I have a motion to approve the minutes of May 9th?
So moved.
By Mr. Kange, seconded by Mr. Sporhees. Any discussion? Hearing none, those minutes are adopted. Disclosures, Danielle?
None.
Mr. Strike?
None.
Brendan?
Disclosures. Sorry, no disclosures.
Thanks. Tony?
I have one in the case 2016-0053, the conditional use, Girdwood Brewing Company. I was not present at that meeting, so I will recuse myself from that.
Q. Andre?
None.
Mitzi?
Concerning case 2016-0053, I was absent for that particular item. And I'm thinking I must have been absent for the one before it, if it was indeed taken up last Monday on the 6th.
So we have the one, the one resolution for approval on the case that you just indicated. That's the only one on the consent agenda right now from last Monday.
Then I will be recused from that because I wasn't here.
Thank you. You'll show as abstaining on that vote. Brandon?
None.
I'd like to disclose that in the matter of case 2016-0059, this is the Mountain View Targeted Neighborhood Plan. As we heard earlier, the sponsor of the plan is actually the Anchorage Community Land Trust. I am a board member of the Anchorage Community Land Trust, have been for about the past year and a half, I think. So certainly since they started working on that plan. Also, you'll note that my company, Cook Inlet Housing Authority, is mentioned in the planning document. So I needed to disclose that. I think, you know, otherwise there's nothing in the plan that pertains specifically to a parcel that my company owns that isn't already an allowed use that I'm aware of. So no sort of change otherwise, but open to questions or comments and certainly a recommendation one way or the other on whether to participate or not.
Mr. Robinson, do you have any financial interest or private interest in the matter?
I don't.
Based on Mr. Robinson's testimony and the fact that he's served on the board, this matter is just a recommendation to the Assembly. I move to direct Commissioner Robinson to participate in the case.
As soon as she gets caught up. So please use your machines to vote.
In regard to case 2016-0059, Commissioner Robinson is directed to participate.
Thank you. On the consent agenda, can I have a motion to approve the consent agenda, which is the resolution to case 2016-0053? Thank you, Mr. Strike, seconded by Mr. Sporhees. Any discussion on this resolution? Yeah, hearing none, this resolution is approved. Brings us to our regular agenda. The first item on our agenda is not a public hearing. It's case 2016-0057, State of Alaska DOT, context-sensitive solutions, transportation project, site plan review. It's actually the design study report for O'Malley Road reconstruction phase one, Seward Highway to Livingston, and phase two, Livingston to Hillside Drive. Is there a staff report?
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chair. This case is a review of the draft design study report for O'Malley Road reconstruction. Phase 1, Seward Highway to Livingston Street, and Phase 2, Livingston Street to Hillside Drive. O'Malley Road was originally constructed in 1962, and with the exception of turn lanes and other safety features, it has never received a major upgrade. O'Malley Road consists of two 12-foot-wide travel lanes with minimal shoulders. A 7.5-foot-wide separated pathway currently exists on its north side, between the Seward Highway and Lake Otis Parkway. And the remaining portion of O'Malley Road east of Lake Otis Parkway has no pedestrian facilities. The purpose of this project is to provide a roadway that accommodates the projected 2035 travel levels or traffic levels, provides enhanced transportation facilities for pedestrian and non-motorized traffic, and improves safety. The proposed improvements for Phase 1 include from Seward Highway to Lake Otis Parkway, widening the roadway to 4 12-foot lanes, a 16-foot wide raised median to separate oncoming traffic, a 10-foot wide separated paved multi-use pathway on both the north and south side of the road, and continuous lighting. From Lake Otis Parkway to Livingston Street, improvements will include two 12-foot wide driving lanes, a 14-foot wide center two-way left turn lane, 8-foot wide shoulders, 10-foot wide separated pathways on both sides of the roadway. Proposed improvements for Phase 2 include two 12-foot wide drive lanes, a 14-foot wide center two-way left turn lane, 8-foot wide shoulders, 10-foot wide separated pathway on both sides of the street, new street lighting, signage, and striping, and utility modification and relocation as necessary. Staff has reviewed this DSR against the standards required by AMC 2103-190-B4 and found that all standards are substantially met. This project conforms to the Hillside District Plan, the Anchorage Pedestrian Plan, the Anchorage Bike Plan, and the Area-Wide Trails Plan. The applicants have considered two alternatives for Phase 1 and two alternatives for Phase 2. The two alternatives for Phase 1 include Alternative 1, a four-lane urban section, and Alternative 2, a four-lane rural section, with the preferred alternative being the four-lane urban section. For Phase 2, the two alternatives are Alternative 1, no action, and Alternative 2, a three-lane rural section, with Alternative 2 being the preferred alternative. Continuous lighting will be provided for Phase 1. For Phase 2, new lighting will be provided at the Hour Road intersection, where the traffic analysis shows a dedicated left turn lane pocket is warranted. Existing lighting will be replaced and upgraded at Elmore Road, Birch Road, and Hillside Drive. The estimated cost to build Phase 1 of the project is $33,300,000, with the estimated cost to build Phase 2 being $24,100,000. So with that being said, staff would like to recommend approval of this draft design study report for O'Malley Road Reconstruction Phases 1 and 2, subject to the conditions found on page 7 of your staff packet. The petitioner and petitioner's representative are here to give a presentation and answer any questions that the commission may have. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Whitfield. Before we go to the petitioner, any questions of staff? I'd like to invite the petitioner down for presentation, if you got one, or Wendy.
Hello, my name is Cynthia Ferguson, F-E-R-G-U-S-O-N. I'm the project manager with the Department of Transportation for the O'Malley Road Phase 1 project. I also have with me Christopher Post. He's the department's project engineer for the Phase 1 project. Thank you for letting us come here tonight and do a presentation on it. I grew up in a neighborhood off O'Malley Road, so it's a project really near and dear to my heart. I could talk about it for a long time, but I will keep myself brief, I promise. As was mentioned in the staff report a little bit about the current conditions, it was originally constructed in 1962 and hasn't had any major improvements since that time. The posted speed limits vary from 45 to 50. And within this segment on phase one of O'Malley Road, the most accident rate is in the top fifth percentile in the state. And if you drive O'Malley Road today, you know that portions of O'Malley Road are operating at capacity with congested conditions. The 2013 average daily traffic was 16,000 vehicles. To address these conditions, reconstruction of O'Malley Road is proposed. It's a little bit different than a rehabilitation, which is for targeted improvements. This will be a complete reconstruction of the roadway to meet current standards and to also address the projected 2035 traffic volumes, which are approximately 21,000 vehicles. The project is planned to be federally funded, with the Federal Highway Administration contributing approximately 93% of the funding and the state of Alaska contributing 7%. The project is included in the AMAT's Transportation Improvement Plan. And throughout the development process, which began in 1999, the department has conducted extensive public involvement and has maintained a project mailing list and website, and most recently with the help of Kinney Engineering. So what is proposed for phase one? As was mentioned in the staff report, the reconstruction is a distance of approximately 1.1 miles. It proposes to construct a four-lane divided roadway with median openings and left turn lanes as appropriate, continuous illumination, which will be an adaptive LED system, which will allow the traffic light levels to be adjusted depending on variables such as traffic volume. We'll have 6 to 8 foot shoulders, which will be signed and striped as bike lanes, and it will have separated multi-use 10-foot wide pathways on both the north and south side. You'll notice in the typical sections before you, the difference there is a curbed and an uncurbed section. We did, after we got into final design, end up with some sections that have curb and gutter and some sections that are just a rural shoulder, and that had to do with addressing the drainage along the roadway. So I just wanted to take you a little bit through some of the major intersections on the roadway and run you through what those improvements are going to look like. So we'll start at the west end of the project at the Seward Highway intersection. This will have curb and gutter in this area. It will also have, in support of the MS4 permit and the Green Roads Initiative, a bioswale. It's a little difficult to see. And that will treat water before it eventually finds its way into the existing storm drain systems at Seward Highway and O'Malley Road. There's also a noise wall proposed in this area to reduce the project's noise impacts on the Commodore Park condominiums. And you'll also notice the median will have a patterned asphalt concrete that'll have a red color. Moving on east to Commodore Drive. This was an area we got a lot of public comment on in the existing conditions. There's a lane merge, and also a lot of folks are turning left on Commodore Drive. So the project will address that situation by providing the two through lanes, so there will no longer be a lane merge there, and also a dedicated left turn lane for Commodore traffic. We're also in this area proposing to lower the hill, which is just to the east of there, by about 7 feet to improve the sight distance. And you'll also notice the bike lane signing and striping. And then we move on to Independence Drive. This is where you'll notice there is a rural section. There's no curb and gutter on the outside of the roadway. This is because there's really poor soils in this area. We were concerned that if we had a curb and gutter section with manholes and storm drains, that it wouldn't, settlement could damage it. So we proposed a rural section here. We're also raising the elevation of O'Malley Road here approximately 8 feet. If you drive there, you know there's a pretty large sag, so we'll be raising that, and that will improve the site distance. We'll also be providing a left turn lane. If you're heading eastbound on O'Malley, you'll now be able to turn left onto Independence to head north. We will also, if you're heading westbound on O'Malley, we'll have a right turn, dedicated right turn lane for right turners on Independence. And also in support of the MS4 permit in Green Roads, the Moose Meadows area, we will have rock-lined ditches that will slow the storm water before it enters the existing wetlands, where it will help recharge those existing wetlands down here. Our next intersection is Lake Otis Parkway. And here you notice we're back to our curb and gutter section. We'll add a right turn pocket for Lake Otis Parkway southbound traffic to turn and travel westbound on O'Malley Road. And also the additional three lanes on O'Malley will reduce the congestion at this intersection. So this is the transition area. Eventually, the divided four lane will taper down to match the proposed O'Malley Road Phase 2 project. And with that, I'll turn the presentation over to Michelle to present Phase 2.
Hi, I'm Michelle Ritter with Dow. As Cindy mentioned, the project does transition from Phase 1 to Phase 2, and with that was a different design team, so that's why we have two different speakers. But the Phase 2 project limits are from Livingston Drive to Hillside Drive. Funding is also a combination of state obligation, general obligation bond and fund and federal funding, and the total project costs are about $24 million. The purpose is to bring the O'Malley to current standards for a minor arterial roadway, overall to improve mobility, usability, and just safety of the roadway. There's a high percentage of rear-end and left-turn related crashes on this section of O'Malley. It will also provide non-motorized transportation facilities. The road will be widened to allow for two 12-foot wide travel lanes and a single 14-foot two-way left lane turn lane in the center. This will allow to get allow drivers going down O'Malley to get off the roadway to make a left-hand turn. There's a lot of residential, commercial, and public access points. There will also be a 6-foot wide paved shoulder that will be marked and signed as a bike lane. And the project runs to about Ridgecrest, and then the center line tapers down, as well as on the south side, the separated trail is eliminated. That's due to the topography and different right-of-way acquisitions. If you were to maintain that width along the whole corridor, we would be cutting up to people's garage doors. So through public comment, that change was made. The two-way left-hand turn increases the traffic flows and accessibilities, and will hopefully, you know, reduce the rear-end collisions, as well as it provides a buffer that protects against head-on collisions. There will also be intersection improvements at Cange and R Road, and there's a long piece of paper that was handed out to you before the meeting, and that has in the center shows those intersection improvements. Primarily at Cange and R Road, the profile of O'Malley will be dropped to provide better sight vision, and there'll be adaptable lighting as well. This part of the project will also include two fish passage upgrades, one at Little Campbell Creek and one at Craig Creek. And construction for this segment of the project is anticipated to begin in 2018. And a lot of all the public outreach that was done for Phase 1 included the Phase 2 efforts. So, and that's it.
Thanks, Mr. Strike.
Yes, thank you. I travel this route every day, multiple times. So this is a good project to see forthcoming. A couple questions. You talked about the sound wall in Phase 1 that would extend, I believe, just into the Commodore Park area. Is that correct?
Yes.
How high is that sound wall going to be?
It will be 10 feet high.
Is there any site restrictions for cars that are coming out on from the Commodore Park, making that right-hand turn with bicycle traffic that may be coming uphill on that side of the road?
It will be behind, so there will be the you mind if I turn to the...
Sure. My concern is just from a safety standpoint. Bicycles traveling at 20 miles an hour there, cars are coming out, and they, how they emerge. Cars tend to look left, not right, for a bicycle moving that fast.
Right, right. So
so here will be the location of the noise wall, and then this would be the pathway. So if you're traveling along the path along O'Malley Road, so the wall would be positioned well behind where you would be crossing.
And as we move up to O'Malley, or up to Lake Otis, I had kids involved in the Abbott Loop, the Abbott O'Rabbit Little League, been on that park, and I've seen foul balls go out, and they go out into the street.
Mm-hmm.
Now we're extending it one more lane and a walking path or bicycle multi-use path that's mm-hmm. going into that area that much more.
Mm-hmm.
Is there anything going to be done regarding requirements for some screening that will prevent loose balls from coming out onto the street?
Not at this time. We did not get a comment from the Abbott O'Rabbit folks on that. There is an existing berm there, but it sounds like it's potentially not high enough if there are any.
I'm out there for 5 years. They go out, yeah. And they've hit the street.
Right.
So just
okay.
A comment there.
Okay.
Now, as we move up forward, the mixed-use path, I believe, stops as we're coming down into... Just it stops midway alongside the Anchorage Golf Course, just for phase one. On the north, it just stops.
Right, it would stop for phase one. We would end because we're anticipating that we will begin construction on O'Malley phase one later this fall. And so we would be under construction for 17 and part of 18. So we would have the pathway would end in the vicinity of the Abbott O'Rabbit Fields until phase two came along, and then we extended that north side path.
It was my understanding that, I missed part of this, that the path is going to be contingent. There's one part of the path contingent upon funding.
Right. We had, on phase two, during the environmental assessment and the early project development, the trails plan included just one trail on the south side of O'Malley, and that's how the project moved forward. As we were developing the project, the legislature provided an additional $1 million in funding for a path on the north side, and the municipality of Anchorage also developed additional pedestrian plans and bicycle plans that included including the Hillside District Plan that included additional paths on the north side. So we were evaluating paths on both sides. We don't quite have enough money if we are just going with state money to build both of those. However, we're following the federal process, so there is flexibility to use a mix of federal and state funds and possibly construct them both. But we are definitely evaluating them both and seeing the impact.
I guess my comment would be that if you have limited funds and can only take it up so far, that a possible likely stop might be the zoo on the north side in order to promote that type of walking traffic activity. Mm-hmm. There already is a substantial amount of even the residents who go to the zoo. So
right.
That I just promote out there, that might be a logical point. Thank you.
Thank you,
Mr. Strike. Ms. Bailey.
I just had a consistency question. I'm looking on if one was traveling by bike from Forest Park to Independence Drive and going to be going straight through. It looks like there is a marked bike path that leads you next to the through traffic. However, if you're heading towards Lake Otis Parkway, there's not a similar bike path set up that way. I was wondering, is there a reason it's different? Is that an oversight? Just because Anchorage isn't the most bike-friendly place, so if we're treating the bike traffic differently, we might be running into problems where cars aren't quite sure what bikers are doing in the area.
And I'm sorry, could you repeat that for me? It was in the Forest.
So if you go from Forest Drive mm-hmm. to Independence Drive,
okay.
It looks like there's a bike path that is essentially two lanes of road, a bike path, and then the turning lane.
Yeah, I'm because we should have continued. We have, and I think I'm missing your question, and I'm not sure. I'm looking in the right spot.
So it's on that map right there. There's a median, and then there's two lanes of traffic, then a bike lane, and then the right turn lane.
Oh.
And then there's not a similar one heading towards Lake Otis Parkway.
Oh, okay.
And so I was just wondering why we're treating the bike traffic differently, why there isn't one there.
Okay.
As opposed to, and just
okay, I'm sorry. Thank you. I'm sorry. So the bike lanes, as they approach a signalized intersection, the bikers who are using the bike lane will have the choice to either exit onto the separated path and proceed that way through the signalized intersection, or to act as a vehicle and travel in the vehicle lane through
the
intersection.
So the difference that one is signaled and the other is not.
Yes.
Okay.
Thank you. Sorry.
Thank you for clarifying that.
That's just a recommendation from Federal Highways or DOT? I mean, it just sort of strikes me as odd that where you might need it more, you have less protection.
It was a lot of discussions between the department and the municipality of Anchorage, because we're not able at this point to maintain and run a signal that would recognize a biker that has a biker detection, basically. So a biker could be sitting at a signal and not get detected, whereas if you're at a ped, if you're on the separated trail, you have a button you can push to get your turn to proceed through the signalized intersection. So it's our current agreement with, if you will, with the municipality on how we were going to treat the signalized intersections with regard to bike lanes.
So it's not because the signal's there and it becomes less safe or more liable, it's just that it's a detection issue.
Yes.
Very interesting. Okay, any other questions? Mr. Walker.
Was the right-of-way, this is a phase two question, by the way, between the AGC, Anchorage Golf Course driveway, and Elmore Road, was the right-of-way widened there, or is it staying? I guess what I'm most curious about is what's happening on the north side there. Is it expanding toward the golf course at all, or? So first...
From the top section?
Yes.
So that's where it will begin to taper down from the phase one, so the five lanes, to the three lanes. So it will go into the widened 14-foot wide travel lanes with the, 12-foot travel lanes with the center lane. But there is a center lane starting at the end of phase one, so at that end O'Malley. And so that widening will go all the way across the golf course.
Okay, so what I was getting at is, so you'll be clearing trees along the boundary between the right-of-way and the golf course?
Correct,
is that right?
Yes.
Okay. So I've never done it, but Greg Strike told me that he's hooked a few golf balls into traffic there before.
Okay.
And I was just curious if you guys have talked to AGC about it or if there's any provision that's going to be made, because I know that it happens pretty frequently.
So I'm filling in for the project manager. So Cindy was actually part of the conversations.
It sounds like there needs to be a separate bullet that's either strikes kids foul balling or him hooking balls. So
we have had discussions with the golf course and Rich Sayers. It's a difficult issue. What we've discussed is potentially a wooden pedestrian fence that would protect the would run along the right of way and protect any pedestrians that might be struck by an errant golf ball.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Any other questions? What's the will of the body? Mr. Walker.
In the case of 2016-0057, I move to approve or recommend the design study report as presented.
Do you include department recommendations?
With the department recommendations. Sorry, I was just opening it up to that page. both one and two.
Great. Thank you for the motion, seconded by Mr. Strike. Any discussion? Please vote, and then I will ask for some findings. That motion is approved. Any findings?
Just that I attended some of the public outreach, and they did an excellent job. The report was great. I think they gave us really, really good drawings so we could understand what was going on here. The design criteria was met, and there were no objections from any of the other agencies.
Great. Mr. Strike.
Yeah, I think from a design standpoint and from a presentation standpoint, this one is one of the better ones we've had in my 3 years here on the commission. And so I appreciate the work and the effort that went into this and the conciseness that it was presented. So I want to thank the presenters in the presentation material here because it was absolutely easier to follow.
Thank you, Mr. Kange.
One last finding. I would just like to point out that AMC 21.03.190B.4, Street Review Draft Design Study Report, Planning and Zoning is authorized to review and approve the design study reports for road projects.
Thank you, Mr. Kange. Concludes that case. The next case is case 2016-0023, Sears, Roebuck & Company, remand from Superior Court, a public hearing site plan review per AMC 2155-130 and AMC 2150-320 for a large retail establishment in the B3 General Business District. Could we have a staff report, please?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. The Planning and Zoning Commission received a request from Sears Roebuck & Company to amend a large retail establishment site plan in the B3 district in accordance with AMC 2155-130 and AMC 2150-320. The Planning and Zoning Commission reviewed and approved this request on the consent agenda on July 14, 2014, subject to 8 conditions. The Planning and Zoning Commission adopted Resolution 2014-40 on August 4, 2014. 6 retail merchants timely filed an appeal of this decision to the Board of Adjustment. The Board of Adjustment held a meeting open to the public on February 18, 2015 as appeal number 2014-4. By unanimous vote, the Board of Adjustment exercised its independent judgment in the interpretation of municipal code and concluded a public hearing on limited site plan review is not required as a matter of law. The appeal of the Board of Adjustments decision was further appealed to the Superior Court of Alaska on December 2, 2015. Superior Court Judge Andrew Guidi ruled that based on consideration of public policy that the Commission must hold a public hearing on an application to modify a large retail establishment. This reversed the decision of the Board of Adjustment in the case and remanded the case back to the Planning and Zoning Commission to hold a public hearing, which we're here today. The petitioner has completed all of the 8 conditions as recommended by the Commission in the Resolution 2014-40, which granted them approval for construction per the site plan. 346 public hearing notices were mailed both on January 21, 2016 and again May 17, 2016. After writing of the staff report, multiple comments were received. Public phone comments had been received in regards to interior access from the mall, and it has been stated that by the Planning Department that interior remodeling is exempted by AMC 2155-130, and the use internal to the structure is not included in any type of review standards. In summation, the department recommends approval of the amended site plan review for the Sears store tenant improvements for Nordstrom Rack, located on the north side of the Sears Mall, subject to the conditions of the original approval resolution 1 through 8, found on page 6 and 7 of the staff packet. The petitioner and petitioner's representatives are here to answer any questions that you may have. Thank you.
Thank you. Any questions of staff? Can I get you to clarify the original conditions of approval? You talk about 1 through 8, and then there's a recommendation with 7 conditions in this staff packet before us. Could you tell me the difference?
The original staff packet had the 1 through 7,
mm-hmm.
and a little bit of history here. During the original hearing, PZC was concerned about pedestrian access from the Nordstrom Rack to the rest of the mall, considering the loading dock, and they discussed, you guys discussed that extensively. During the Commissioner Walker brought up the to amend and add the one condition that reads, amend the plan to include signage or otherwise to significantly, in all caps, promote access to the common areas of the mall through the Sears store. So that was added as a condition, making it 8 total conditions, which we are recommending tonight to match the resolution.
So you would recommend that we carried forward?
Yes, all 8 conditions as found in the resolution 2014-40.
Thank you. Any other questions for staff? From a procedural standpoint, your recommendation or our process here tonight is to invite the petitioner forward, open the public hearing, and hear public testimony, and then what we're being asked to do is reopen the case at that point in time, or what's your suggestion after we hear testimony here this evening? Are we sort of re-examining the full case? I mean, I think we have a combination of petitioners that were here as well as those that were not here previously, right? So is this as though we're starting over again, or we're starting from the standpoint of having approved and the specific criteria of the court is to listen to public hearing based on that decision that we made?
Yeah, the reason, Mr. Chair, the reason we're here tonight is the court has made the decision to remand this back to simply just hold a public hearing.
Thank you for that. Mr. Strike, question.
Yes, and through the chair to the staff. Of these 8 conditions that were presented, has staff been able to ascertain whether all 8 conditions have been met?
Through the chair, Mr. Strike, they have been met, yes.
That's an affirmative.
That's affirmative.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Strike. Any other questions? Okay, at this point, we are going to open the public hearing, read the rules. Procedure by which the public may speak to the commission at its meeting is, after the staff presentation is completed on public hearing items, the chair will ask for public testimony on the issue. Persons who wish to testify will follow the time limits established in the Commission Rules of Procedure. Petitioners, including all of his or her representatives, 10 minutes, and part of this time may be reserved for rebuttal. Representatives of groups, community councils, PTAs, etc., 5 minutes, and individuals, 3 minutes. When your testimony is complete, you may be asked questions by the Commissioner. Commission, you may only testify once on any issue unless questioned by the Commission. An individual may have appeal rights relating to any action the Planning and Zoning Commission takes, except Commission recommendations to the Assembly, which are not appealable. Appeals must be filed with the Clerk's Office within 20 days after approval by the Planning and Zoning Commission of the resolution, which is the Commission's final decision. A fee for the appeal is required at the time of filing. Could we have the petitioner? And please state your name and spell it for the record and let us know how much time you'd like to reserve for rebuttal, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I'm Joseph Reese, R-E-E-C-E, from Davis Wright Tremaine here in Anchorage. I have with me from the petitioner Seritage Growth Properties, James Bree, and Brian Walsh is here as well from Seritage. Tim Potter, who needs no introduction, is here on our behalf, and also Scott Broadwell from my office. We'd like to reserve 5 minutes for rebuttal, and what we're here is concerning a July 2014 decision by the Planning and Zoning Commission that was upheld on all counts by the Board of Appeals and was appealed to the Superior Court simply on the question of whether there should be a public hearing, which is why we're here today. Mr. Bree.
Chair, Commissioners, thank you for your time. My name is James Bree, B-R-Y. I'm the Executive Vice President, Development and Construction for Seritage Growth Properties. Seritage Growth Properties last July acquired the Sears at the Mall of Sears in Anchorage, Alaska, in an acquisition which encompassed 266 properties around the country. We're in the process of evaluating those properties and repurposing them. Working with cities, civic associations, and communities to hopefully energize the properties and bring new life and physical improvements to those which are considered beneficial to all at hand. And again, we'll reserve 5 minutes for rebuttals.
Thank you. You got more than that. Any questions for the petitioner? Okay. Is anyone else wishing to make a presentation at this point? Is that good? That's it? Okay. Oh, question for Mr. Strike. Go ahead.
Well, I did present a question to the staff regarding the conditions. Just for clarity, on item number 8 condition, how did you meet that condition?
Can you remind me which one's number 8? That's the signage?
Amend the plan to include signage or otherwise to significantly promote access to the common areas of the mall through the Sears store.
So there are signs on all the corners of the building identifying which way you should go to get to the Nordstrom Rack or the Sears.
There are signs at all corners.
Yeah, on the exterior of the building.
I've traveled that route. In fact, okay. I did it this afternoon. I know one sign on the east side that's about halfway between the Sears entrance and the exit from the entrance to
the Nordstrom Rack. Yes.
There's one sign under the awning on the sidewalk area.
Yes.
And the other one is a sign that's about 15 feet high, attached to the loading dock, that actually promotes going that route to access the Nordstrom Rack. So there's actually a sign promoting go through the parking lot.
Well, there are signs directing you which way where the Nordstrom Rack is and which way the Sears are. If the signs are considered to be unclear, we would gladly amend them.
I've got pictures of them.
If you feel they're unclear, we'll gladly work with staff to improve the signage.
I was confused.
Okay.
In fact, I saw it being promoted to go into the parking lot area, and then I've gone into the rack coming out, and as I come out the door, there was nothing obvious left or right as to which way I should go, other than there's three bollards to prevent me from going into the parking lot. But if I turn left, there's nothing to say, hey, go the other way if you want to go to the Sears Mall or into the other area. And in fact, if I turn right, I don't see the sign unless I've got my glasses on and looking up, small sign up above the awning. And that's about 55, 60 feet down, about halfway between the two entrances. My initial inclination is I don't know that we've met this condition.
Okay.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. I see no other questions for you at this time. Like to open up the rest of the public hearing. Please come forward. Again, state your name and spell it for the record. Indicate if you're testifying on behalf of an individual or group. When you see this little yellow light in the middle, turn. You've got a minute left. So please start to wrap up at that time.
Hello, I'm Sonia Sienkowski, S-E-N-K-O-W-S-K-Y. And I live off Highland Road and have been an Anchorage resident and shopper at the mall for 20 years. I'd like to direct your attention to the video while I talk to orient us. We are on the north side of the Rack store looking east toward Fred Meyer and the Seward Highway. And you can see that the entire area on both sides is part of the adjacent parking lot. And the scenes you are viewing were captured on three separate occasions. I've also made a point of driving by several times in the last couple of weeks and seen this independently to some extent or another myself. And I'm just going to let this play out while you watch. You can see people of all ages using that as a walkway in all weather.
In my opinion, the removal of a sidewalk and the entrance have both contributed to this unsafe situation. Add snow and ice, and this is an accident waiting to happen. Thank you.
Thank you. I have a question for Mr. Strike.
Yes, and thank you through the chair. When were these pictures taken?
There is one from the opening of the store, and we feel that that's, although it's an exceptional situation, it's also the equivalent of a sales situation or another special day, such as around the holidays. And the other two, I don't know the exact dates.
I think you answered my main point, that that was the opening day, but it, again, your
explanation. Only one.
But your explanation, too, that this could be typical of a sales. And I did note the signage that was about 15 feet high, promoting that as an access route to make it to it. So thank you.
Mr. Walker.
If you don't mind my asking, are you here today as a concerned citizen or representing a group? I see you're wearing a mm-hmm. sticker or a badge or something that has a person in a car, which kind of resembles it. So can you elaborate on that a little bit? Or?
Yeah, I actually, I'm here speaking as an individual. I have been working with the group of merchants at the mall at Sears, helping them, and actually, it was when I saw this video that I was personally most struck by the situation, because I hadn't understood what was going on over there until I started delving in.
So if you've been involved, obviously, what do you suggest as an alternative to what's in place now?
Well, a dedicated interior access of some kind would be the easiest way to both get people out off of the sidewalks, out of the potential, you know, winter weather, rainy weather, so forth. I did walk the other path through Sears and was kind of surprised that that was considered the way you're supposed to go. That just doesn't seem to me like a permanent long-term solution. There's no it's not obvious which way you go. There are things in your way as you're walking through. It's like an obstacle course. So to me, it seems like if there were another hallway, you would not only make it really clear, hey, that's where you go, that to get to all of the common areas, it would also be more like the mall that I grew up with, or not grew up with, but I've been living around for 20 years. And it just, as a shopper, it was my expectation when I go into the mall that I'm able to hit all the stores. I was personally disappointed not to be able to go straight from one place to the other.
Thank you.
Roundabout answer. Excuse me.
Thank you for your testimony. Mm-hmm. Anyone else wishing to testify?
Good evening. I'm Peggy Robinson. I'm the interim president of Midtown Community Council. That we've met last Wednesday. This was on our agenda. I just took over being in this role last week as well. There hadn't been any discussion about this of appeal previously. There were 12 of us that were voting members at the meeting. Most of them actually were there for the marijuana licenses, so that they were not, we chose not to take a position on this. However, that I do want to say that, you know, in comment or response to a comment that was made before the meeting started, a number of us are moving to Midtown from other parts of town. I moved here from East Anchorage because of wanting to live where it's easier access, easier walking and biking to a number of amenities, which includes to the Sears Mall. And so that the safety is very important for people to be able to get around, and especially as we get a little bit older as well. I was very involved with Northeast Community Council some years ago and involved when Tocotinu Commons was being planned. And as we were working with the outside developers there, that their, you know, concept was of spreading out the stores as they are now, with these huge parking lots in between all of the stores, meaning that often people end up having to get in their cars and driving to another part of the parking lot so that they can be fairly close to the businesses where they are. What we found is outside mall developers were not at all really interested in making accommodations for working with us with the amount of snow and ice on the ground and how we live multiple parts of the year. Of looking through comments that were presented and in the documentation, I was seeing the same kind of comments from Nordstrom's designers, that they were not at all interested in any accommodations that might meet our specific needs. They did not want to have more than one entrance to the store. Absolutely, that was off the table. They wanted it an outside entrance. They could care less about how their design was to the rest of the businesses. We want to have a strong, large number of businesses in town and in Midtown, and as services to people that live here and who work here. So even though, you know, as community council, we have no official positions, that there are some concerns. As far as, you know, solutions at this point, with number four, I would, and a suggestion that I saw that somebody had made was, if you put in bollards alongside the building on the side of Northern Lights, to then have a protected walkway there so that it's protected between the bollards and the building, and then move the parking to either eliminate all the parking that's along there or perhaps change it in a way, but at least of having a physical barrier between where people work and making it obvious. Just painting, you know, sidewalk on the pavement that's going to be covered up 6 months a year doesn't really cut it. So I would suggest that. But it's also really not fair to expect Sears to have all of this walk-through traffic of people who may not be wanting to buy anything. And I've done that. And, you know, I'm going down this aisle and that aisle to get from one of their store entrances to the other to get around to the rack. And if Sears closes or decides to rechange again their interior, then what are you going to have left? You conceivably that you won't have any even close to interior access. So thank you.
Thank you. I have a question for you, Ms. Barker.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I think, Ms. Robinson, you may have already answered this question, but I'd like your, and I know it's just conjecture, but I'd like to hear your opinion as to why you feel, or maybe in your experience you've noticed, that shoppers are more inclined to exit the mall, go out into the cold, wet, whatever, go around to get into the rack, as opposed to making the pathway through Sears, which is warm and covered, to a covered walkway and to the rack entrance.
From my personal experience and of looking at it, one, that it's shorter, probably it's easier and appearing more direct to go outside. That if you go into Sears, the front door or the door coming from the mall, you cannot look down that aisle and have a clear straight shot to where the door is on the east side of the parking lot, that you're going down and you're maneuvering through here and there, and there's shoppers in a hallway. And so that the speed of that, and, you know, if you do have a wheelchair or a walker or something like that, it makes it much more difficult to do that.
Thank you.
Thank you for your testimony.
Okay, thank you.
Anyone else wishing to testify? We've got a number of people here. Can I see a raise of hands, but who's intending to testify here this evening? Okay, well then what I'd like you to do
at least the next person in, if you could queue up so we can keep things moving along, that'd be great. Good evening, sir.
Mr. Chairman, commission members, my name is Dale Parth.
Could you raise the mic up just a little closer? Thank you.
And I'm here to speak to the issues of the standards of 2150-320, 2155-040, and 2155-130 regarding large retail establishments with regards to this case. The proposed site plan eliminates the sidewalk on the north side of the building at the rack, and as we have seen, forces pedestrians into a traffic area. 2150-320 requires under pedestrian access that sidewalks shall be provided along the full length of any building where it adjoins a parking lot. There was such a sidewalk which has been partially removed, reducing conformity in lieu of increasing conformity. Community spaces are also a requirement of an LRE. The community spaces provided in the mall are no longer directly connected to the rack space and then are provided in the rack space. This too increases nonconformity. Under 2150-320, aesthetic characteristics, long walls are to be broken up by such things as windows, arcades, or overhangs along at least 60% of the building length. The west elevation had a building overhang over approximately 80% of the building length, which has been reduced to 60%. The north elevation has a building over had a building overhang over 80% of its length, which has been reduced to 65%. The west elevation of the racks space used to have an overhang along 50% of its length that has now been reduced to 0%. 2155-040 requires that no structures may be enlarged or altered in a way that increases its nonconformity. The proposal in general moves toward increasing nonconformities rather than reducing them. In addition, 2150-200 requires that the commission shall only approve a site plan if it finds, in addition to other criteria, that it will not have an impact on pedestrian and vehicular traffic circulation and safety. In my opinion, this proposal falls short of the citations cited, most notably the impact on pedestrian safety.
Thank you, sir. Could you spell your last name first, please?
It's P-O-R-A-T-H.
Thank you. Mr. Walker has a question for you.
So you're an architect, right?
Retired.
Okay. And are you here as a concerned citizen, or are you representing one of the parties that's involved?
I'm here as a consultant to Cargill's team.
Okay. Okay. What do you suggest as a retired architect? You've got a lot of years of experience behind you.
Well, I'm not here in a design capacity, but I think that one of the other speakers is going to address what were proposed solutions earlier, but that for some reason didn't happen.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, sir, for your testimony. Sure, you can.
Worthy members of the Planning and Zoning Commission, my name is George Neuerberg, N-E-U-E-R-B-U-R-G. I'm the GNC franchise operator at the Sears Mall. And I stand this evening as one of many merchants in the Sears Mall that has been directly impacted by your decision to allow Sears and, in turn, Nordstrom Rack to alter the composition of the mall. I hope to highlight three major areas that create numerous problems with the board's decision, namely access, continuity, and safety. Let me address each one of these in turn. The decision of the board to allow Sears and Nordstrom Rack to put only one entrance to the Rack store and eliminate the outdoor sidewalk access limits access for all customers in the mall. The concept of a mall is that all merchants are equally accessible to every customer. In addition, the seating areas are also accessible to everyone in the mall. Each week, my employees have dozens of mall customers asking us how they can get to Nordstrom Rack from inside the mall. They are forced to explain the complicated access route through Sears. The second problem is with this decision is continuity. Again, the concept of a mall is that once a customer enters the building, whether through a mall entrance or through an outside merchant entrance, the customer is then able to have a continuous shopping experience. By changing the composition of the mall, customers are denied that continuous experience. Third, the decision, as it stands, adversely affects the safety of customers accessing the mall. What a disaster it would be if Sears closed and customers could no longer access the Rack by going through Sears. That's denoted by the red line on your handout. Out the east door, down the sidewalk. Since there is now no sidewalk on either the north or south side of the building, customers in the mall who wish to shop at the Rack would be forced to walk through the traffic lanes of the parking lot, crossing the entrance to the Rack loading dock to access the entrance to the Rack. That's denoted by the blue line on your handout. Finally, I urge you on behalf of the merchants of the mall at Sears to reverse this decision and require Sears, and in turn Nordstrom Rack, to provide a safe interior connection to the Rack, as well as any other merchant who may occupy the unleased space by customers in the mall. Customers expect a safe, continuous shopping experience with access to all of the merchants in the building. Put yourself in the shoes of a customer in the mall. Wouldn't you want access to all the merchants available to you? Thank you for your attention.
Thank you. Good timing, Mr. Strike.
Yes, thank you. Question. Are you speaking to an interior access to the Rack from the mall?
Yes.
Or from Sears?
Well, through Sears into the Nordstrom Rack seems to be the only logical way to do it, unless we went to the north end of the Sears store and put a hallway there.
But don't we run into the same problem that you referenced earlier, that if Sears closes, then we have no access again?
True. True. So putting the hallway then on the north end, right down the wall where Nordstrom Rack is, would then solve that problem. Yes, it would take away a few hundred square feet from the 145,000 square feet that Sears has, but I think it's well worth it for safety's sake.
Thank you for your testimony.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Jack Lewis, LWIS. I'm a 30-plus year businessman in Anchorage. I have a burger farm at the Mall at Sears, the Pima Farm, Salomon Company, McGinnis Irish Pub, Fire Top Red Houses, and soon Krispy Kreme Donuts at Muldoon and DeBar. If I see somebody smiling, so okay. I took a lease at the Mall at Sears, and I was very excited when I heard Nordstrom Rack was coming here, because I thought it was going to be a game changer for me, because I thought I was actually leasing space in a mall. The traffic counts in Philippe haven't really been anything measurable, in my opinion, you know, for BurgerFi itself. So it's been very disappointing. For my customers coming around, it's been a real big inconvenience. It doesn't really act like a mall. I thought it was good. We were trying to enhance properties. I've been in business in Anchorage an awful lot of years, and normally, boy, I'm forced to do things that sometimes I think are, you know, mind-boggling for improvements. And then when I see something like this, I've got to say to myself, wow, how does that happen? And I'm forced to put in some other walkway or new parking design or some sort someplace else. And I'm going, wow, that makes sense there, but and I had to do that, and I'm going, wow, how did I get by? So it's been a big disappointment. I'm not even here for safety issues, although the video was pretty strong looking at that, I have to admit. So it's the first I'd seen the video. I am here for really self-serving reasons. You know, more traffic, I'm a small businessman. I look at other retailers in the mall. Nordstrom's Rack is a big player. You know, I mean, it's hard not to be excited when they got here and they took that location. But as for the retailers in the mall, I think they have to feel a bit shortchanged because the access is not there. It's acting less like a mall and more like, a giant strip mall of some sort. So it's just the design seems just wrong. And, you know, I am here for self-serving reasons, but I'm trying to get more traffic down the hallways there. Nordstrom's Rack, I don't know what their customer accounts are coming through, but they're probably sizable. From the capitalistic view of things, should be nice that all the retailers can enhance themselves a little bit. They thought they were in a mall. I'm sure I speak for a lot of people in there, smaller business people than myself even. So it's been a disappointment. I was very excited about it. I was anticipating it, but it hasn't been the big hoop. I think a lot of it is just the exit is weak. I didn't understand what number 8 was. I guess it was a criteria of some sort there that they had to meet. Well, it sure didn't sound like they met number 8. You know, number 8, if that's what they consider reasonable access to the common area of the mall, I think that's something we have to take a hard look at. You know, that didn't seem like number 8 was met at all. Signage-wise, I've driven around there. Mr. Strike, I didn't even see the signs you were talking about, because I was trying to pay attention. What is the access here? And I took a good hard look at the north side.
Thank you, sir. Your time your time just went up. Is there any questions, Mr. Lewis? Thank you for your testimony.
Thank you for your time. Thank you very much.
Hi, my name is Julie Garner. Last name is spelled G-A-R-N-E-R, and I'm here as a merchant in the Sears Mall. I can speak as being a consumer, being that I've lived here for over 20 years and now a business owner, seeing the impact that it has on the handicapped community. We have lots of handicapped that come to the Sears Mall because they're comfortable. It's a smaller mall. There's a lot of home health care companies that actually bring their clients to walk through. If those clients would want to go to Nordstrom Rack, they usually will ask our employees and say, hey, how do we get to Nordstrom Rack? We have to tell them, well, you have to walk outside, you have to walk around. Well, some people are in wheelchairs. That means they have to go out, get the customer back in their wheelchair because they're not going to put them at risk and bring them back. We consistently have consumers that come to our store and say, hey, this is unsafe for us. I personally drive because when I drive home, I take that way, and I have to avoid hitting people. I have to be careful, so never mind looking at what's the painting on the concrete, but I'm trying to avoid hitting someone because there's always someone walking to or fro that area. It is a very dangerous area. I also can speak as a mom. I have a 17-year-old daughter that just started driving. Well, whenever she comes to the store on the way home, I'm concerned that, hey, be careful, you know, make sure that you're looking, you know, so it's just a concern for us as not only merchants, but also as parents or as shoppers. I hardly ever go to Nordstrom Rack because it's so inconvenient, and that's just my inconvenience. But when I think of the customers that consistently are coming to our store complaining about these things, it is a concern. And what I want you guys to consider is, let's not wait till a tragedy actually happens and then we sit here and revisit the same issue and put ourselves at risk. So let's avoid a tragedy before it happens. I think that's the way we function as Americans. So if you guys have any questions as far as my solution, well, I'm not an architect, but the obvious solution is that there would be an access through the Sears Mall somehow, you know, and I'm sure that if they made such a great store, and they can probably figure a way out to do that.
Thank you. So that your solution was some sort of interior access.
Some sort of interior access, and I'm sure that Sears and Nordstrom Rack can work that out.
Great. Thank you for your testimony. Mm-hmm.
Hi, I'm Mark Hellenfall from Hellenfall & Associates. We were commissioned to conduct a survey, face-to-face survey, of the patrons of the mall at Sears. This excluded Sears itself and the Nordstrom's Rack. In other words, we conducted the survey of people that were in the rest of the mall, if you could want to include those two stores as part. We talked to 400 people, and we asked them a series of questions. The basic summary was the mall at Sears patrons believed a common interior hallway connecting all stores in the mall is needed for their convenience, access, safety, and the compatibility of the mall. First, a very sizable majority, 95.5% of the mall patrons, believe Sears' removal of the north side sidewalk, that's the Northern Lights, is less safe for people walking between the Nordstrom's Rack and the rest of the mall. Second, the mall at Sears patrons' opinion, 96.3%, new stores only facing the Seward Highway are not compatible with the rest of the mall. These all come in, I guess, your criteria, public safety, compatibility, and current or efficient patterns. Three, a huge majority, 93.6% of mall patrons, would be more likely to shop at more stores if all stores were connected to a common interior hallway. Four, 27.3% of mall patrons would be very likely to get in their car and drive from the Nordstrom's Rack to or fro the rest of the mall rather than walk. And 28.1 were somewhat more likely, or very much more likely, but a whopping 27.3, very much more likely. Five, and this comes under your large retail store standards, an overwhelming 96.3% of the mall at Sears patrons considered stores facing the Seward Highway with no interior connection in the rest of the mall as negatively impacting accessibility and convenience. And last, finally, the mall patrons believe that the stores that only face the Seward Highway, that's the mountains in other words, should not be able to count the seating areas in the mall as meeting municipal code requirements for a common area where customers and visitors can congregate and relax. Again, the summary is the mall at Sears patrons believed in overwhelming numbers a common interior hallway connecting all stores in the mall is needed for their convenience, access, safety, and the compatibility of the mall.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Bob Martin. I'm a broker and owner of Ravenwood Real Estate, focused exclusively on commercial sales and leasing. I've been in the business since 1983. I'm a member of the Certified Commercial Investment Institute and earned their CCIM designation, and also an active member of the International Council on Shopping Centers for 10 years. I'm here as a concerned citizen tonight. In my 33 years in the business, I've learned one immutable law. When it comes to retail, malls live or die on foot traffic. The lack of a safe way and clear way to travel between the mall and the rack decreases foot traffic. There's a healthy synergy that develops between small shops and large anchors. Shoppers enjoy the experience of moving back and forth between the two, and are inclined to spend more time and money when they have a more diverse shopping experience. Placing a barrier such as not having a well-defined interior access or at least a safe sidewalk between the two cripples this experience. The consequence is that the mall shoppers will eventually go elsewhere. As a result, the smaller stores, which are mostly owned by local entrepreneurs, will suffer from fewer sales. Their reduced sales will ultimately translate into their business, the value of their businesses declining. In addition, the mall's ownership will see declining rental rates and increased vacancy. So in order to keep both the businesses and the mall healthy, there has to be a safe and friendly access between them and their larger anchor neighbors. So again, malls live or die on foot traffic. Questions?
Thank you for your testimony.
Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Cynthia Henry, H-E-N-R-Y. My family owns and operates the Hallmark store in the mall at Sears. I'm here to express our concerns about the safe access and the elimination of the safety hazards to our the customers who move from the Nordstrom Rack into the mall at Sears. There is no convenient way and safe way to walk from the Rack into the mall. No sidewalk around the building. Folks are compelled, if they take that fairly long route, to walk in traffic. And this includes moms with or dads with strollers and folks that are in wheelchairs or other assistance. I have a new understanding. I had surgery on my foot in January, and I've always been cognizant of the needs of people with a handicap. But as I was on crutches, I'm more concerned than ever about access and walking across a parking lot for a long distance. Hindsight is 20/20, and sometimes decisions that seem simple are not. I don't think you anticipated this outcome when this was approved 2 years ago, but sometimes a redo is in order, and this is one of those times. It would have been better to have held this hearing before the project moved forward. Hearings are a good way to, I've sat on your side of the desk and often been amazed at the ideas and new information that comes from the general public. But it's not too late to fix it. The first indication we had in our store in the mall that there was a problem of access is people would come in and say, how are you supposed to get into the mall from the Rack? So we would talk about walking around the building, and people were sort of taken aback because it's a long distance, and especially in the wintertime. Or we would say, well, then go outside and go in the other entrance, the main entrance of Sears. Well, people would come in and say, I've been wandering around Sears for 15 minutes. It's not Sears' job to have a runway into the mall. They're merchants, and they set up displays, and they change their configurations. And so people don't know how to navigate through Sears in order to get into the mall. You know, I typically don't think that government should make a lot of decisions for businesses in the private sector. But there's an important safety issue here, and it's also a violation of Anchorage's really superior efforts to promote this city as a livable winter city. Anchorage has led the way in our state for doing that. Anchorage has tried very hard to mitigate the bad effects of cold weather, and I would hope that you would consider doing that on this case. Thank you.
Thank you. I have a question. Go ahead, Mr. Strike.
Yes, thank you. Thank you for testifying. You are the third or fourth shop owner in the mall to identify directing persons to reach the Rack to go outside the building. Were any of the store owners that, or yourself ever approached by Sears or by the landlord on how to promote access to the common area or how to promote the reverse access?
We weren't approached. I think our goal was to suggest the best route out of two unfortunate choices. And so that's what we've done. And the outside route is not acceptable to a lot of people, and it's a long route. And then going through Sears also has its challenges.
So the inside route was identified to the shop owners as an option?
No, I think we just know them all, and we came up with those. Those are the only two options. But I don't recall being approached by the mall with suggestions of what we should tell customers.
Thank you.
Thank you.
My name is Dick Stallone, S-T-A-L-L-O-N-E. As an owner of an independent local clothing store for more than 40 years, mall store owners such as myself have been getting an earful from shoppers ever since the Rack opened. Everyone started out excited by the prospect of a new retail neighbor, but we have all been disappointed by the renovations allowed for the Rack. The definition of a mall is when all retail stores are accessible by a common inside passageway, allowing for a safe and convenient shopping experience for its customers. The customers of our active, busy mall have been impacted by the renovations that were permitted. A sidewalk around the perimeter of the rack was removed, eliminating a convenient, safe walkway. Also, an interior section of the mall's access to the rack was cut off. This lack of direct access to the rack from inside the mall has forced customers to walk outside onto the parking lot, dodging traffic. These changes took customers by surprise and created access issues they did not expect. It has caused a great deal of inconvenience as well as safety hazards, especially for those with mobility, senior citizens, and those with young children. When you look at what happened, it just seems like public safety and building standards got left out of the discussions. Under municipal code, older buildings like the mall are supposed to move towards new design standards. When they make changes, not step backward, as the rack was allowed to do. Instead of the rack being an asset to the mall, it has become a liability to public safety. Thank you.
Mr. Strike.
Thank you for testifying. I appreciate the definition that you used for the term mall. But I guess I would point out, having also lived up here for some time, there was also one other store that never had inside access to the mall. And that would have been the Oak and Cake, the liquor store.
Well, you could go through. Well, no, you had to go outside.
Never had access to the inside of the mall. Okay, thank you.
Okay.
Thank you, Mr. Stallone.
Hello, good evening. My name is Sherry Mansfield, M-A-N-S-F-I-E-L-D, and I want to thank you for hearing us. I'm here representing my five partners and I at Creative Chaos, so speaking for our small business, our very small business, and as a citizen of Anchorage and a shopper of the mall. I've lived here since 1962, so you know I was about this big. Sears and the Sears Mall has been a staple of my family's life. Since I became a business owner in the mall at the end of February. At the time, I did not even know that there was a way to get through Sears to get around and get back into the rack. And at the end of February, I just want to tell you about two instances of people that I had to explain to them how they had to go outside the building. The first was a weeknight, very late, you know, near the end of business hours. It was dark. And these three young women came up to me and said, how do we get to the rack? And I said, well, you're going to go out that door right there because we are immediately across the hall from Sears and across from GNC. We make up that first little intersection on the east end of the building. So you're going to go out that door, you're going to walk all the way to the end of the building, and you're going to go around the corner again, and then you're going to see where you enter the rack. As the mother of a 20-something myself, I was not really comfortable sending these young women out into the dark along what looks like the back side of a building. Nobody could see them from the interior of the building while they were traversing that way, regardless of whatever traffic might be there. And we all know that there are citizens around the building that are not necessarily shoppers in the building. The last person, they didn't believe me at first when I told them they had to exit the building and go around the end. They thought I was joking. Last week, I had a woman who was obviously a senior citizen on a walker who was with her daughter who had some sort of physical instability, like maybe cerebral palsy. I didn't ask. They asked me how to get to the rack. I told them, you got to go out that door, go down to the end of the building, around the corner. They said, we can't do that. I said, well, you know, I have a disability myself. I have a balance disorder. I wouldn't do it either. That's just what I wanted to say to you. Please consider that.
Question from Andre, go ahead.
Why wouldn't you tell them to go through Sears?
I did not know there was a way to go through Sears.
Okay.
You were questioning before whether the shop owners knew. None of my partners have told me that there is a way to go through Sears.
Thank you for your testimony. Mm-hmm.
Good evening. My name is Brian Swartzentruber, S-W-A-R-T-Z-E-N-T-R-U-B-E-R. Most people call me Brian. So, I work for the landlord at the Sears Mall, and I'm in the facilities department, so I'm responsible for all the snow removal. And I understand that it was suggested that the sidewalk, the city sidewalk that runs alongside Northern Lights, was suggested to be a safe pedestrian route for people that didn't want to walk through the parking lot. Well, I'm here to tell you that that is the most dangerous sidewalk to walk on. And we have tried to maintain that sidewalk in the wintertime, and only to find out that the state of Alaska, who does all the plowing in the street, uses it as a snow storage berm. So that sidewalk is pretty much impossible to use as pedestrian access, and most people that do walk along that route will divert through our parking lot, which is maintained a lot better. And the other thing I wanted to say was that on that west side of Sears, where that used to be an entrance into Sears before the rack remodel was done, we have 10 handicap spaces there that we put in that were utilized mainly by the Sears customers. And after the building was renovated, there was only 4 handicap curbside spots in front of the rack. And I can tell you from personal experience, there is a need for a lot more than that for the people that want to park and walk into that door. So that's just my personal observations. Thank you.
Thank you for your, oh, I got a question for you.
Thank you. Since you do a lot of the maintenance, you're familiar with it. As I look at the map that was handed to us earlier, and you'll note, I note there's 1, 2, 3 other areas around the mall that also don't have sidewalks adjacent. That would be the loading dock area behind the former cars, and both sides of the Sears where you have the automotive on one end and you have where the sidewalks then stop, as well as their loading dock area doesn't have sidewalk.
Right. Well, the loading dock side of cars, we have an entrance pretty close there, and that part of the parking lot really wasn't utilized that much by customers. They would park closer to the doors. We have a lot of parking over there that's available. So, and we also have handicap spaces right in front of those doors at that entrance, at the southwest entrance adjacent to the former car store.
But do you see much pedestrian traffic on the Sears side between their loading dock area?
They have a funny situation going on over there. They have people that travel in the opposite direction in their car along Benson, and I can't figure that out because that's pretty scary, you know. But most of the people that do park near that that entrance there park pretty close to the door, and they don't have to cross a very heavy vehicular trafficked area.
In the past, there had been pedestrian issues. The same issues that we're talking here for safety, there used to be pedestrian issues there along that back side.
Yes.
And then folks then crossing the Benson, 4 lanes of traffic. And there's been fatalities in the past because people using that as a shortcut back and across Benson.
Oh, people running across, yes. Benson, yes.
But again, they're cutting across as a shortcut, so that.
Right.
But thank you.
Yeah, and I also wanted to mention, too, that even though the Oak and Keg did have an outside entrance, but it had a well maintained sidewalk between the car's entrance and the Oak and Keg, so you didn't have to step into the parking lot. So. Just wanted to note that.
No, I understand, and I was characterizing the definition that was being used for the term mall.
All right. Well, thank you.
Thank you.
Hello, good evening. My name is Maria Talas, T-A-L-A-S-Z. I'm here as a rack shopper and a private citizen. I do work in safety and for a consulting firm. Not related to this project, but I was just curious if a tragedy occurs, who is ultimately liable Tragedy is usually for a little bit, and then becomes numbers, and then it becomes lawsuits, and then it becomes money related. So is it ultimately the municipality, or is it Sears, or can it be both if the municipality lets a situation exist or persist, even though it's been pointed out as being a hazardous condition? So where is the liability? Who's going to pay if there's a child that ends up under a car? People are on cell phones. I mean, the number is staggering of how many people are distracted drivers. So if you have the opportunity for people, and they may not be the traditional rack shoppers, we talk a lot here about older people or handicapped people. There's a lot of people that may not necessarily fit the picture of Nordstrom shoppers or rack shoppers. Who's ultimately responsible if something happens to those people that may not have been intended to go that route? The opportunity is there. They will take it. We recently moved into a new project where there's a roundabout situated in an awkward way, and there's prohibited left turn signs on the property, and there's people going left on the roundabout. We had to have a cop police that roundabout, and I'm being told, well, those left turn signals are not muni sanctioned, so you don't really have to respect them. So as soon as you start to muddy the waters with what is really code and what is private and what is the margin that may have, you get all kinds of confusing situations. So it's important that we're all very clear in that. And then if the malls are revigorated without being a mall, we just heard people saying, well, a mall is by definition such and such a thing. In Lower 48, it said malls are dead. But when there are dead malls, other stores pop up, but the signature is that they're accessible by bicycles, walking, or easily accessible. So this doesn't fit either bill. And then our live, work, play city.
Just wrap up, ma'am. Your time's out. So if you got a final, thank you. Are there any questions? Thank you for your testimony.
Okay.
Good evening. My name is Alan Safer. I was brought here this evening as a consultant speaking to the economics. I'm an MAI appraiser. That's like a CPA for real estate. I'm not going to deal with the safety issues. That's outside my expertise. But I appraise regional shopping centers, community centers, power centers. I do a lot of retail analysis for underwriting, for banks, for bank loans, the collateral. What I want to address is the mall concept. A mall is a collection of shops centered around anchor tenants. And anchor tenants bring the shoppers to a mall, and then they get out of their cars, and they go inside the mall, and they walk the mall. They go from one anchor to the next anchor, and in between there's all these small business people. And they depend on that traffic, that pedestrian traffic. So when people talk about traffic at a mall, they think cars, but it's really foot traffic. They get out of their car, they go in the mall, and they walk back and forth. So mall design has an entry on the south end and on the north end, and on the east end and on the west end is like a cross. And it's cross people. There's a community. There's a town center. It's where people go to meet people, drop off your kids. There's some entertainment value, but shopping is entertainment. So really what you're talking about is the small merchant. If there's somebody that's being damaged here by this concept, is by dead-ending one end of the mall, you're turning that into a power center. Now, a power center also has another name. It's called a category killer, because these large big-box retailers suck up all the sales, and people don't spend money at the small shops. So an enclosed mall is meant to be people getting out of the elements, being able to go there, whether they're the elderly or the young, and actually commune there, actually have community, and shop while they're there. Now, you are damaging those small shop owners by dead-ending one of those entryways, and you're diminishing the property value because the rents that you're able to charge are going to go down, and the businesses and their value to be able to sell that business as part of your retirement, that goes down as well. So I'm only addressing the economics. There's also one other concept. I think I have a couple of minutes, maybe a minute. It's something called parking utilization. So you have all these parking stalls all around the mall. And when you have a mall that functions correctly, they can park down on the one end where cars used to be and walk all the way down to Sears or the Rack. And all that parking is used effectively. When you have a dead end where people can't really access those shops at the very far end, they're only going to park in front of the store that they want to shop at. It's called a destination tenant. And then people depart and they go home. Any questions?
I do have a question for you, Mr. Strike.
Yes, thank you for that explanation. But I'd take that perhaps a step further, because now you have the mall that is regenerating itself, and they're creating outdoor access, of which two of their current shops now are promoting not the inside access, but the outside access.
So you have the two types of tenants, the exterior access where they're not circulating around the mall, and that's a destination. And then you have all those shops on the inside, and they're benefiting from the agglomeration, the combined drawing power of all the tenants in the center. So those are the tenants that are really being damaged. The exterior access also being damaged because you have just fewer shoppers coming to congregate at the mall to have the community space.
Now you didn't indicate who you're consulting for.
I'm consulting for Carr Gottstein.
Okay. But Carr Gottstein's model, that it would appear, is to create more outside entrances to their tenants.
I think that's pretty opportunistic. You know, you have a mall that's not functioning as well as it probably should be. And I've studied a lot of malls like this in the past. So when you have a mall that has a dead end, and I've studied a bunch of them, those sales start to plummet for those shop tenants. They start leaving because they can't make a living there. And as you have more and more dead stores, at some point, that's when you have the big boxes come in. Demolish the small shops, put in all the big boxes, and you no longer have an enclosed mall.
Okay, I follow the dead end, but I just see the two new stores that now have new entrances to the outside on the part on the side of Vince, the Wi-Fi Burger and
right.
Steam Dog.
Right, and I had dinner at the Wi-Fi Burger, and it was a terrific, terrific restaurant. Okay.
I'm sure the brander here would like to call it BurgerFi, so let's get it.
Yeah, I apologize. I'm just new to town, right?
It was his fault. So I have a question for you from Ms. Parker.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm curious, because of your profession and work, obviously, you've done in other places besides Alaska, if you're familiar with and could comment perhaps on Nordstrom Rack's locational preferences that you may have observed in other areas?
I'd be happy to. So there's the Nordstrom department store, which in fact is becoming more and more challenged with the internet sales. Nordstrom Rack is the hot new property, and they're going into all the other areas that they can. Those are all their new units. They like being freestanding. They don't have to be in a mall. But the couple that I'm personally aware of have many accesses. In downtown Seattle, there's the Nordstrom Rack in Westlake Mall, which is a vertical mall. They took over the entire lower level. And so they have access through a little stairway at the top, and it goes down. But then they also come off that, and they go out into the Sound Transit Tunnel, et cetera. So it's really, if they want to be in that location, they'll accept a lot of different design issues. It's a function of negotiation. But the Rack is absolutely a big draw. And if you can get the people that come to the Rack convenience to be able to go inside and circulate in the mall, all those tenants will benefit, and that mall will retain its vitality. The way it is now, it's a dead-end tenant. It's really not going to benefit the rest of the center.
Mr. Spinelli.
Do you think that the mall benefits from having the Rack there?
I believe it does.
Thank you, sir, for your testimony.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
Hi, my name is Linda Boggs, B-O-G-G-S. And before I start with this, I want to address a couple of questions that have come up. One with Mr. Strike on Oak and Keg. If you go back, I'm not sure that liquor stores could open any place but outside when that store was put in. As I remember, Fred Meyer had to fight really, really hard to get their stores to open into the space. So I don't know, but it would be worth looking at because at one time those things were really strict, and I think that was the case in the 60s when that store was built. And also the other stores, BurgerFi and Steam Dot, that open out to Benson have exposure on Benson, but they also have interior entrances, so they aren't cut off from the rest of the mall. So now I'll start with it. You've heard a lot tonight about the negative impact that the RAC has had to public safety, but the conformity issues are important too, and I think it is clear that the mall has moved out of conformity in many areas as well. Before this remodel, Sears Mall was nearly ideal in terms of keeping customers out of the weather, off of ice and snow, and it seems clear that forcing the public out of that comfortable, protected environment to get between stores in the mall clearly makes the site worse in terms of the Northern Design Standard. Next, it's inconvenient. Any reasonable person will say it's insufficiently inconvenient, which I think comes from the standards, to go from a climate-controlled interior walkway to an exterior roundabout trek that's 7 times further to reach the same interior space. In fact, the mall actually has an average of 6,000 to 7,000 customers a day. And when we did market research before the RAC moved in, we would estimate that about 1,200 of them would like to shop in the RAC, but I'm sure the RAC isn't seeing that. So it kind of goes both ways when you make it hard. And finally, there are no community spaces in the RAC, and a plan that walls off the mall seating area with no long-term guarantee of any interior access cannot reasonably claim that the mall's amenities can satisfy that requirement. The vast majority of the people that I talked to, that we heard from in the survey, and that you've heard here tonight are telling you that this seems to be the case. The large retail establishment sections of the code have been misapplied in a way that has made the mall less convenient, less winter-friendly, and the stores and community spaces are less accessible. It also seems that if this plan is approved, it's basically telling other large retail establishments that the design standards are no longer being enforced, and I don't think that's what you want to do. If you read the intent section of AMC 2155, the chapter that the large retail establishment section falls under, you'll find it specifically states that nonconformities shall not be enlarged. For these reasons, I encourage you to not to approve this application based on the general standards for site plan approval, as well as because the building cannot move away from conformity, and ask Seritage to come up with a plan that is up to code.
Thank you. Well done. A second left. That was impressive.
Thanks.
So my name is Bob Mintz, and I work for Carr Gottstein Properties also. And I'd first like to start out and say two things. First, that the Nordstrom store designer was in fact amenable to a connection to the mall common area, and that's the first page on the handout that I just passed out. And the email stream is attached to it. And it's also attached to a letter I wrote in January or February, but the graphic wasn't attached, so that's new. Secondly, the original conditions have not been satisfied, in my opinion. First, I don't think that the signage significantly, in all caps, is adequate. And if you also look at plan sheet, the condition of approval 1 refers to plan sheet A201, and that doesn't match what was built. And it was a condition of approval, so that I would contend that the certificate of occupancy was erroneously granted. So I'd like to start out and mention the broader context of this controversy. Sears and Kmart are both owned and controlled by a hedge fund, and the Sears and Kmart companies are dying. Same-store sales have fallen for the last 5 years, and their core customers are shopping elsewhere. In fact, a recent survey found that women prefer shopping at Goodwill over shopping at Sears. Sears lost $1.1 billion in 2014 and $1.8 billion in 2015. In one recent year, Sears' cash balance fell from $1 billion to $250 million. In 2014, they closed roughly 200 stores and began downsizing their stores and leasing to other tenants. In 2015, they raised cash by selling 250-ish stores to Seritage for $2.7 billion and leasing the stores back. And under the Seritage lease, and that's portions of that from securities filings are in the handout, allows Seritage to take back Sears store space from Sears and lease it to other tenants. In most of the stores that Sears sold to Seritage, they can take back 50% of the Sears space. In Anchorage and 20 other centers, they can take back 100% of it and lease it to someone else. So that having been said, that's kind of the big picture. I'd like to make a few observations about the proposed site plan in Title 21. The site plan that was deemed conforming upon adoption of the larger retail establishment ordinance, is that my minute left?
That's your 3 minutes. Is there a question for Mr. Mintz?
That was it?
Three minutes goes fast. I would ask that you quickly tell us a little bit about this, your opinion on the site plan, but don't wander too much.
Okay, then I'd like to submit. So on the site plan, alternatives, is that what you're talking about?
Sounds like that's where you were headed.
No, I think the whole site plan stinks. Is where I was headed, and that it doesn't conform with the zoning ordinance, and that this body doesn't have authority under Chapter 35, Section 200 to even approve it. That's where I was heading on the site plan.
So you believe the site plan itself, so the site plan that we're reviewing has to do with a limited site plan based on the fact that it's considered to be an approved site plan when we receive it. Whereas the Sears Mall, if you were to apply the site plan approval process to the entire Sears Mall, it's likely to be extremely deficient of all of the big box
it
standards.
It absolutely will. And that's why when the big box ordinance was passed, that at that time, every store more than 20,000 square feet became nonconforming. And so instead of putting those stores in a position where if they wanted to make any changes to the site, they would be forced to bring it into full conformity. They were deemed conforming in their current state, and they were required to spend 10% of money spent to bring it into greater conformity. But nothing in the big box ordinance exempted them from the nonconformity section in general, and it was never contemplated that they were being allowed to do what nobody else can do, which is become less conforming. And secondly, the Chapter 35, Section 200 affects what this body can do in connection with approving any site plan, and it doesn't meet the standards. You can't make the findings that you're required to make to approve the site plan.
Can I ask you another question? Is given that you're pretty knowledgeable in the retail arena, could you tell me how you would have handled the loading situation for the Nordstrom Rack?
If it had been me, I would have done it the way I've seen it done in other big box scenarios, and that is that the tenant spaces facing to the west could have been an area where the truck backs in. Sidewalk could have been continued. There could have been, a lowered curb there. And I've seen then a gate, that pulls over, so that when the truck is entering or exiting, somebody opens the gate, supervises the truck crossing the sidewalk, and the sidewalk stays intact.
Okay, great. Thank you for your testimony.
You're welcome.
Oh, Mr. Walker, got a question for you.
So I understand that, I mean, I understand you think there are some other underlying issues here that make this.
Well, there's no guarantee that Sears is going to be around, probably won't, and there's no guarantee that anybody will be able to walk from any of what's currently the remaining Sears space into the mall.
Right. So I guess what I'm asking, what I'd like to ask you is, I mean, you understand the situation probably as good or better than anybody here. I see you've the very first page of the handout you gave us, and I haven't had a chance to look through this yet, but it shows an interior, a proposed interior access. Did your architect prepare that?
Or? Oh, we must have prepared like 10 different versions. That was the one that the Nordstrom Rack store designer marked up and thought was acceptable.
Okay. And I'm not sure we're going to get them all explored here tonight, but I think there's a lot of overlapping issues of who controls what. I'm imagining that your organization controls the common area up to the Sears store.
That's correct.
Okay. And then who? Can you tell me who controls the parking along the north side there, the area that everyone is contending is so unsafe?
It's the parking along the north side that used to be there was part of what I'll call the declaration, the CCNRs or shopping center. And it's supposed to be common area, and it's supposed to be not built upon.
I'm sorry, not what?
Built on.
Oh, built on. Okay. So for that reason, we would contend the loading dock is...
Well, I would, but that's just another reason. It has nothing to do with the zoning, per se. It's
okay. So I guess what's going through my mind here is we're being asked to reconsider this, and obviously your organization and the other merchants would prefer to have an interior access from the mall to the Nordstrom Rack.
It's more than that. We think that we can't tell Sears what to do, but we can say that what they propose in this site plan is not something that the law allows.
I understand that. I guess what I'm getting at, though, is so what you're telling me is that you don't think I'm imagining somehow remodeling the parking along the north side to allow for a sidewalk, and I mean, obviously you guys wouldn't like that. That's what you're telling me.
The loading dock and the truck area shouldn't be there at all as far as we're concerned.
Okay. All right. Thank you, Bob.
Thank you.
Oh, Mr. Spinelli.
Can you tell me a little bit about the form of ownership of this property?
Sure. Yeah. So the Sears Mall and the Sears store are on property owned by Sears, except for that part, a strip of land along Denali, and there's actually a property line that goes through the old produce department of the car store. And so Sears owns and controls the space that is where their store is located, and they lease to Cargotstein Properties the remainder of the ground where the mall and most of the car store was located.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you for your testimony. Oh, here we go. See, it's Bob. It's as hard on this side to control as it is on the other side. So these guys, who's up? Oh, geez.
I'm not sure the question was answered when it was asked. Who, I think it was, controls the parking lot to the north side of the rack. So that parking lot area.
It's common area.
Who owns it?
Owns it? Sears.
Sears owns that parking lot, and it's deemed a common joint use area?
Yes.
But Sears owns that area.
Sears owns that. They own the space under the Sears building, the space under the mall, and the space under most of the car store. And actually, it's not Sears anymore. It's Seritage, even though the ownership is pretty much the same.
I'm going to ask the Seritage folks the same question, but I know you're very connected to this. So my understanding is that Seritage is a spinoff of Sears, that Sears has equity in Seritage.
No.
Do you know anything about that?
Seritage is a separate company.
I'm pretty sure you just explained the relationship. Is that not right? I mean, didn't
Well, actually, you've got what the S-11, which was what Seritage filed when they it's the first comprehensive document they filed with the Securities Exchange Commission that pretty much explains it. It's a separate company. The Sears shareholders were given rights to buy stock in it, and Sears sold its property. Seritage took the money from the stock and borrowed more money and gave it to Sears.
Thank you.
Thank you.
My name is Jim Reeves. I'm a lawyer. I represented the retail merchants in the case that involved the public hearing requirement. And my purpose in speaking tonight is limited. My hope is to make sure that the Commission understands our legal position about the role of the Commission and the scope of authority, if we could say, of the Commission in addressing this case, because I think there may be some doubt about whether everybody in the room is on the same page here. So I'm going to put it to you the way we see it. I've also done that in a letter that was, I hope, distributed to you, and I'm willing to answer any questions anyone has about that letter. It's an unusual case, obviously, both from a procedural standpoint and I think on the substance of it. From a procedural standpoint, we emphasize that the effect of the court's decision was to send the case back for a fresh start. The Board of Adjustment decision was reversed, set aside, void. Your prior action is not legally effective because it was done in following a hearing that didn't comply with what we now understand to be the public hearing requirement. So while your prior decision has no legal effect, it's history, it's useful history. But we look to you to give us the fresh start that the court has determined that we're entitled to. And we're appreciative of all of the effort and attention that you're giving the case. Point number one, what happens inside the building is relevant under these laws. The staff may have paraphrased the law a little liberally in seeking to protect the status quo by saying that, or by asserting that you have no authority or responsibility to consider anything that happens in the interior of the property. That's wrong, as we point out in the letter with reference to the code provisions. What happens inside the building as a result of a proposed modification is absolutely relevant, as the code makes clear. Second, this is lawyer talk here. This is a discretionary decision. There is some sense in the room, perhaps, that if a party comes in with a fancy application and brings a phalanx of people to the meeting, they're entitled to approval. This is a discretionary decision, and even if you don't think...
I need you to wrap up. Your time is out. So just tell us why you think it's important that there's a discretionary decision.
It's a discretionary decision because there is no absolute right to approval. If the applicant meets the standards, then that gets through the door, and you can then consider what you want to do with it.
Got a question from you, a couple questions.
Yes.
Mr. Strike first.
Yes, thank you, through the chair. How would you see a successful conclusion to this case?
Well, I think just thinking procedurally here and without reference to what all these other folks have advocated, it seems to me you have two basic action alternatives. One is to reject the application because it doesn't comply with the code. The other would be to grant it subject to conditions which you think are sufficient to achieve compliance with the code. And I don't know whether you can do that on the law, I mean on the evidence that's presented to you, but I think, you know, just thinking procedurally, those are the two alternatives. Reject it, approve with conditions.
Question from Mr. Walker.
I think it was suggested earlier that we don't have the authority to approve this. Would you agree with that?
Well, it's a matter of how you apply the code to the facts that you've learned. And as I understand the argument, the code prohibits what I'm referring to as backsliding on the standards. As I understand the arguments, this application is guilty of backsliding. It leaves the property in a position that's further away from compliance than it was before the modification. So if that's the fact, and it's up to you folks to work through that, then that violates the anti-backsliding provision of the code.
Thank you. All said.
Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody else wishing to testify? Anyone at all? Last chance. Okay, could I ask the petitioner to come back, please? What do we got, Lori? We have 8 minutes and 55 seconds remaining.
Yes, Mr. Chair, Commissioners, I'd like to first talk about a couple of things that Mr. Rees brought up, and Mr. Rees is well experienced, but I think the staff got it right here, not Mr. Rees. The fresh start analogy is not appropriate. This was a decision made by the Planning and Zoning Commission, by the Commission. It was appealed to the Board of Appeals. The Board of Appeals upheld your findings and the conditions imposed on every respect. The only appeal that was done from there was an appeal of whether there should be a public hearing. That was sent back for the public hearing. There was no appeal of the decision that found, that the Board of Appeals found that there was that the board did not have the authority to consider an inside entrance to the mall. That's not part of what the code permits you to even consider. There was no appeal of the modifications that whether they increased or decreased the lack of conformity. You made a decision they did not decrease the lack of conformity. That was, the Board of Appeals upheld you. That was not appealed. There was no appeal or no appeal of any of the other findings of the board, and so you have the authority to listen to the testimony. You have the authority to consider, for example, whether the signage is adequate, whether those conditions, and that's what you have authority to do. Mr. Bree will continue.
So, since Sarah just taken the property and we've been involved in the case and understanding everything that's going on, we've been working with our engineers to try to understand what may be an approved condition along the northern edge of the building. I'd like to pass this out to you. So what we're proposing is to an approved sidewalk, to add a sidewalk along the wall that's the screen wall against the loading dock, make sure it's a continuous path accessible, which there is already. We would reduce the head-in parking, propose some parallel parking so that there's still two-way traffic along the northern edge. We're going to propose improved lighting. We're also proposing some speed bumps for some safety reasons on the side, and we would absolutely improve the signage in both directions, not only directing you to the stores, but directing you from the stores, the pathway into the mall. We'd also recommend that improved signage from listening today, improved signage, directory signage inside the mall of how to get out to Nordstrom Racks could be added as well.
Other than questions, is that it for your rebuttal?
Yes.
Okay. Mr. Kange.
Thank you, through the Chair. I've got a question for Mr. Reese with regard to the conclusion and order. If you could, just a bit of clarification. Just a bit of a clarification, Joe. So I'm reading kind of this last paragraph in conclusion and order, and it says the Board of Adjustment is reversed. The case is remanded back to Planning and Zoning Commission for further proceedings consistent with its order. And so in your opinion, they're saying that it's just because of this, what says the last sentence in the prior section just requires a public hearing. That's your contention.
That's my interpretation of it, yes. Appellants had the right to appeal any number of things in the Board of Appeals, and they chose not to. And so, that's upholding basically the findings that you all made initially. And so we don't have an order from the judge saying any of those interpretations of the code are wrong. All we have is that it's sent back to you to listen to the public. And the public may well bring up some issues on the conditions that you want to refine. That's something that Seritage has already here addressed and is willing to work with you on that. And that's the scope, to me, of what the Superior Court did when it sent it back.
So then to the petitioner, you think that we heard a lot on safety. I think that was, and that's my main concern. Obviously, a lot of the economics from the shop holders, we like to look at in a way, but really we're here for the best interest of the public and public safety. So would you be amenable then to some sort of, and for lack of a better word, some sort of beefed up safety as you've kind of proposed here and worked that out with staff? And I guess through staff, I know that one of the conditions that I think Mr. Walker proposed last time was, some sort of pathway. Have you guys been presented this before and amenable to working with petitioner on that?
Through the Chair, Mr. Kange, staff is amenable to working with the petitioner to resolve the access issue around the north side of the property.
Okay. I think that's all the questions I have. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Walker.
So I'm looking at this site plan, this improved site plan that you've presented us with. So do you have the right to tweak this parking area under the CC&Rs? And I mean, I obviously have no knowledge of any of that. So
we believe so, yes.
Okay. I know that this is not something that you think we're here to decide, but I'm going to ask you some questions about this anyway. I see there, Bob Mintz gave us his memo, and it shows a drawing from your architect at one point that you had considered an interior access. Can you elaborate on why you chose not to include that?
Actually, I'm going to let Brian answer that one.
Okay.
Hi, my name is Brian Walsh, W-A-L-S-H. I was previously employed by Sears before Seritage. So I worked closely with Bob Mintz to try to kind of accommodate his request that Nordstrom have an entrance into the mall. After months, working closely with Bob, various iterations, both Nordstrom and Sears decided they didn't want to do it. The plan that he showed you, or that was in the staff packet, did not have a loading dock, I believe. All the plans we've ever worked through showed loading docks exterior. Nordstrom does not change their prototypes very easily. They can't just go to a location and say, we're going to have, you know, an entrance here, entrance here. They've got set prototypes. They've got point of sales, their back of house. They couldn't make it work here. And we were within our rights under the REA, under site plan review, you know, not to require an interior entrance. So,
did Kargatstein Properties did they ask you to pay to get access, or was this just sort of a mutual thing that you were negotiating on?
Did they ask us to pay?
Yes.
For the improvements?
No. So what I'm asking you is, in order to get an interior access, right, if you had gotten it, would they have required you to pay so that you could have access to their common areas?
No.
Okay. I think that covers it. Thank you for your answer.
Thank you, Mr. Walker. Ms. Bailey.
I just want to more so make a comment than ask a question, that I think your interpretation of the law is almost completely wrong. You said that appellants had a right to the appeal. However, if you read the order from Judge Weedy, he mentions that, first, the court concludes the commission must hold a public hearing on all proposals. This is on page 10 or 12 of his order. He then goes further on to say that even though the commission chose to address the Nordstrom Rack proposal at its regular meeting, it heard only from one party, Sears, before voting to approve. Continues on then saying, but any right of appeal is meaningless without an opportunity to build an evidentiary record at the level of the initial decision. He then goes on to say, any such appeal will place an appellant at an unfair disadvantage, as the application will likely highlight the proposal's economic benefits and minimize any potential drawbacks and complications. Thus, the ability to appeal without a meaningful opportunity for public input does not adequately protect the affected party's interests. So I think based on that, we are at the very beginning drought stages again.
You done, Ms. Billy? Okay, thank you. Ms. Barker.
I'm sorry, could I address that for a
moment? Yeah, go ahead.
I think that maybe we're talking about two different things here. And I understand what you're saying. There are certain findings, for example, whether the interior entrance is something that is within the jurisdiction of the, whether the code permits the interior entrance to be part of this site plan review. And that was found by the commission at the beginning, and upheld by the Board of Appeals to be not the case. That's not the way they read the law. So that's the kind of thing I'm talking about. If they read the law differently, if the appellants read the law differently, they could have appealed and asked the Superior Court to say, no, Board of Appeals and Commission, actually you're not right about that. We don't read the law the same way. Instead, there was no appeal, and so that part stands. Now, that's not to say that the conditions that were imposed could be adjusted by after the public comes in and talks about things like the public safety and that sort of thing. You know, those are legitimate issues that are raised, and you certainly have the right to address those and the obligation to address those, and we don't argue against that. So there's kind of two different things, you know, that we're talking about here. Legal findings on interpretation of the code is one of them, and that's what I was talking about. And I'm sorry if I wasn't clear enough in the way I put it. But the other part, other than legal interpretations, that's what you go back for a public hearing on, and that's what I think you do have discretion to talk about, and that's what we're trying to address.
Ms. Barker.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Condition number 8 in the resolution states to amend the plan to include signage or otherwise significantly promote access to the common areas of the mall through the Sears store. In your proceeding, with construction under the terms of this resolution. Obviously, you accepted that condition. And it appears to this observer that you have failed to meet it. And I'm wondering what remedies you would propose to do to meet that condition.
So, Ms. Commissioner, we acknowledge that there is signage there, and it seems to be ambiguous or unclear on how it directs people. So I am suggesting that we go back and add signs, change the text of the signs so that it's very clear on what they're saying. I mean, I would say today, admittedly, that they seem to direct you to the Sears or to the Nordstrom Rack. They don't direct you back into the mall or the common areas of the mall. So that would be one thing to add, is to put a sign as, this is how you get to the mall, something a lot more straightforward than what's there today. And we would do that very quickly. We're willing to do it now.
Thank you. It just seemed like, you know, more the emphasis has gone on how do we tweak this external access, which is really like, you know, putting more relish on a bad hot dog.
When I stood up, I think I presented three things that needed to be addressed. One was the sidewalk being returned back to the north side of the property so that the accessible route is there. Second one was improving the signage or replacing it altogether with what the signage that's on the outside of the building. And I also suggested that, hearing from the shop owners, that it would be useful to have directory signs inside the mall that direct you how to get outside.
This commissioner would like to see a wayfinding strategy and some samples of how you intend to approach that.
Absolutely.
Thank you, Ms. Barker. Mr. Strike.
Yes, thank you. In earlier testimony, we heard reference to common area seating, and I would ask, what are the Nordstrom Rack requirements for this common area seating that was referenced?
Nordstrom actually does have a common area seating in their store.
It wouldn't common area seating within the store, not common area seating.
It's not in the interior of the mall.
Is it part of a calculation that each store is responsible for as part of their lease? The notation here that I heard in testimony was they shouldn't be allowed to include the seating in the mall as any part of their common area seating if you can't access them.
If I may, Mr. Strike, part of the big box ordinance includes the sort of common amenities.
Right.
And the question then becomes, first of all, in this case, you're dealing with a limited site plan review that's really looking at 10% of that, right? So keep in mind, the case is about reusing an existing footprint of building and changing the way that it's accessed and utilized. This is not new, right? It's just reconfigured. And so within that, the question becomes, the commission gets to weigh in on whether or not they've achieved the 10% required of them, which in some cases, in some reviews, has not been any part of reexamining that common area. But if you were to take it and look at it, you could say previously if a Sears store has access to that because they have access to the mall. So if you wanted to look at it and say you're actually removing, that's the argument being made. You're removing it. So you're going less toward, you're going away from conformity. That's the argument we've heard tonight.
Right.
So the question is, if you buy that, have they offset it enough by what they've provided?
And what has been provided?
They've got a section of their store which serves as common area. There's couches and chairs. I don't know what the classification is that you're using, you know, in the interior of the mall where the tables and chairs are.
I think what we're getting at, and I'm going to ask staff to weigh in, but we're getting at the heart of the matter, which is whether or not we're re-looking at the entire case at this point in time, right? I'm not sure whether or not this commission reviewed the entire case package as originally submitted to evaluate whether or not it made, you know, the previous commission's finding, whether they still agreed with it, right? So to some degree, if you haven't really read through the packet that was dropped on our desk here this evening, You don't see the full site plan. So, Mr. O'Dell, do you have a point? Okay. Any other questions for the petitioner? I had a quick one. We heard a lot of testimony about access through Sears, and if Sears were to go away, what would happen? So is it true that there's common ownership of that building?
No. We own the building. Sears is a tenant.
So if you have a condition – But it's your building.
Yes.
It's your building. So can you tell us what would happen if Sears were to go away, if they were no longer a tenant that was closed down, it was vacant space, boarded up? How would you comply with condition number 8 in that situation?
We could do two things. First would be to repurpose the building and release it.
Okay.
Until that event occurred, we could create a corridor through the space to maintain that access.
Okay. So you don't think that's a big issue?
No.
Sears's survivability is not an issue as it relates to access through Sears?
No.
Okay. Mr. Sporhase.
Thank you, Chair. Kind of to piggyback on your question, and should Sears go dark, you said that you'd have a corridor to the space. Would that be kind of adjacent to the Nordstrom Rack? Would it be through Sears currently? Do you have an idea?
The easiest way to do it would be just to run it straight through the Sears space, like mm-hmm. assume that the store is not there. It's closed. You run a 20-foot corridor right through the space, keep it lit. And that's how the doors align on Sears also. The entrance into the mall is directly opposite of the parking lot entrance out in to and from the Sears.
Sure. So that being said, what's the major impediment to having a corridor from the interior side of the mall to along Nordstrom Rack that's not interfering with the rack's, you know, point of sale, security, labor costs, and an additional entrance into the mall, but what we have here is we have a power center on the east side and basically an interior mall on the inside, and then on the east side, or excuse me, on the west side where Cars is and, say, Whole Foods, which is in the packet. You know, if they were to put a store in and didn't allow access, we'd be doing the same thing with them, right? So how do you kind of appease everybody? And the question is I don't think this exterior access sidewalk is what the patrons want or the mall tenants want. And so where's the major kind of, again, impediment on a corridor that is closer to the Nordstrom Rack entrance, kind of like Bob Mintz, you know, suggested? Yeah. That's my question.
At this time right now, Sears is in possession of that space, and then until they are, and then in the future, I mean, the requirements that you're talking about, mm-hmm. some of those are also our civil agreement between them and us.
Okay.
You know, it's a different set of rules that govern that.
Sure.
To some extent, and we would, and those rules say we must maintain a store entrance onto the mall, and we will. We'll continue that.
Okay. And so I was under the impression that Sears and Syracuse are two separate companies, but that has there been discussion at all of a corridor through to the east side of the building?
No, not currently. There were, I think previously, when Sears was the owner of the building and they were originally, they're the ones who negotiated the lease with Nordstrom Rack, there were those discussions, but not recently.
Okay, thank you.
If I'm not mistaken, that was a previous site plan that was shown.
Correct.
To you.
Correct.
Okay. Any other questions for the petitioner? Any at all? Hearing none, go ahead. The public hearing is closed. Thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. Walker.
We've got a lot in front of us here. Can we take a break and pick up?
Give you a 5-minute recess. Yep. We're back in session. We're missing one commissioner. Hopefully he will show up here shortly. Mr. Keynes, you have a question.
Thank you. Through the chair, I've got a question for staff. You know, obviously the biggest thing that I really want to get some clarification on tonight is the varying legal opinions that we've got in this case. We've heard from the petitioner's representative's attorney, Mr. Reese. We've heard from Denise Bailey, and I forget the other gentleman that was up here. I'm reading this a certain way, but I'm not an attorney. I'm curious if we've had the legal department give a review that can give us some guidance. That do we have to take this back to as if it were a new facility and look at every single component of that, of the code, or do we look at this as public testimony only? I'm curious if we've gotten a legal opinion from the Muni on this, I guess is the bottom line question.
Through the chair, Mr. Kange, no, municipal attorney has not given us any legal direction.
So in terms of the issue as to whether or not, I would approach this one of two ways. If it in fact is starting over, then we would make findings on all of the conditions related to the big box ordinance and the conditions of the requirements of the old code. If this was solely that it was remanded at us for public hearing, then I would look at it as though our conditions on all of the other matters were likely still to be our conditions, and if there are issues that were brought up in the public hearing, and I would wager that there have been, that were ineffective or they didn't go far enough by the previous design, then we would limit our action to those things. But it's an important distinction because, first of all, I'm not sure we're prepared to do either, but I know we're not prepared to do the former here this evening.
Mr. Chair, the Planning Department has stated that, you know, it's remanded back as a public hearing. Further than that, if you, as the will of the body, commission wants to go down the road of adding a condition, that's up to the Planning and Zoning Commission.
What's the will of the body? I mean, again, I hopefully my question was clear. I mean, if we were taking this up anew, we would march through all of the conditions of approval, you know, and reform, look at all of the conditions. We would likely re-examine the site plan in its totality. We would look at elevations once again. We would do all of that stuff, which has not even been presented to us here this evening, right? Or we would have, through the public hearing, been made aware of a couple of deficiencies potentially to that previous review. It's an important distinction to make.
Mr. Chair, members of the commission, I think it's there's a question as to what process to go down to simply hold the public hearing or to hold a public hearing and make a new decision. If the commission is uncomfortable making a decision tonight, staff would be happy to consult with municipality's legal counsel to make that determination and come back to the commission with further guidance.
Mr. Strike.
Yes, thank you. And I guess there could be some distinction that not all commissioners were seated at the original presentation. And so depending on how staff recommends how we proceed, I think we're locked in one way that only tonight that we could proceed, if that were the choice, because to review the whole piece as it was presented, it's a totally different presentation that we heard. We didn't hear the petitioner's presentation that we heard in the first case 2 years ago.
Exactly, yeah. Go ahead, Mr. Gange.
You know, I'm not one for kicking the can down the road, but I really, given the fact that the public testimony here tonight, I would really feel more comfortable having the Muni attorney weigh in on this. I apologize. I know this is, you know, 2 years in the making, but I would move to postpone this case to the next available day or until we've got some clarification from the municipal attorney. Again, I apologize, but just with the information I have, I can't make a decision.
So motion to postpone made by Mr. Kange, seconded by Mr. Walker. Ms. Bailey.
I would just, I'm going to be voting in favor to postpone this. Based on what I've read, I don't feel comfortable voting today, and I think we do need more counsel on this issue.
Question for staff. I closed the public hearing. You have any thoughts as to whether or not this needs to be postponed? What I don't want to do is go through the testimony that we just heard this evening again. But I also, to the degree to which we're going through a full review of the standards, it's certainly minimally appropriate to hear from the petitioner.
Through the chair to the commission, I suppose that we could consult with legal, come back to the commission. The petitioners could make a brief presentation to refamiliarize the commission with the issues in this case, and then the commission could then make a motion and rule in this case.
Can I, what I'd like to do is get a motion to reopen the public hearing at this point in time. So I don't know if I need you to withdraw your motion temporarily, but to get that out on the table. And the reason is this: if we close the public hearing and later find out we need to reopen it, then you all likely would feel compelled to come up and give the same testimony all over again. I think it's in all of our benefits to save that time. You are on the record right now, and I just want to make sure that you remain on the record. That's the point of this conversation.
If Mr. Walker is willing to take a second back, I'm willing to make a new motion, or concede my motion.
So, Danielle, your motion?
My motion is to reopen the public hearing.
Thank you. Seconded by Mr. Strike. Ms. Barker, do you have a comment?
I have a question, perhaps a point of order. Can the public hearing be continued if it remains open?
That's why I'm trying to reopen it, so that we can continue it. But again, procedure. I need some direction here on how this works. Are we giving a specific date? Are we just reopening it?
To a date to be determined, okay, or uncertain.
So but that would mean that all this other testimony remains on the record.
Thank you. I just wanted clarification.
Any objection to the motion to reopen the public hearing? Hearing none, the public hearing is reopened. Can I have a motion to postpone? Mr. Kange.
Thank you. With regard to case 2016-0023, I move to postpone to a future date to be determined.
Seconded by Mr. Walker. Any objection? Hearing none, we will see you at another time. Thank you here this evening. Sorry for the clunkiness. We do have another case for some folks that have been patiently awaiting to discuss the future of Mountain View, so if you folks can leave quietly, it would be much appreciated. Could we get a staff report, please, on case number 2016-0059, recommendation for adoption to the Assembly of the Mountain View Targeted Neighborhood Plan?
Yes. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. John Sussell with Long Ridge Planning Section, Planning Department. Case number 2016-0059 is the Mountain View Targeted Neighborhood Plan. You previously heard had a work session on this item. I'm going to dispense with any lengthy kind of staff report, but I would as a matter of immediate interest bring to your attention to lay on the table the revised staff report. It's dated June 13th. and that is item G2 in your packet. The reason for the revision relates to a meeting that staff had with the Mountain View representatives from the Mountain View Community Council as well as the Anchorage Community Land Trust last Friday. We had a very fruitful discussion, and in addition to which, staff had received a letter from Mary Dugan, who is the staff planner with Joint Base Elmendorf-Richardson. So with those additional items, staff felt it necessary to, and we appreciate your consideration of the revised staff report. Having said that, as we discussed earlier, essentially the staff brought back some recommendations which are highlighted on page 4 of 19. Those relate to some of the sort of last remaining outstanding issues. It's in the staff's opinion and our recommendation that all of those issues have been, will be resolved with the targeted neighborhood plan that has been presented to you as part of the packet today. We reviewed the item number one, which is the map color issue, just a clarification. We also reviewed the half-block change in zoning back to or to light industrial from its mixed-use corridor designation. Number two, we added some, suggesting some additional language about the mixed-use corridor description, as well as some ways in the document to cue the reader as to the description of that mixed-use corridor and how it particularly applies to the four blocks on the east end of the mixed-use corridor on Mountain View Drive. Number three, further discussion about the medium-density residential narrative on page 57 that relates to the other the residential area adjacent to Jay Bear and Davis Park. And then number four, which was brought to our attention on Friday relating to the Davis Park lease with Jay Bear and the municipality and encouraging the municipality and Jay Bear to bring a resolution to that matter, because I guess it, well, I don't guess there is, it's in limbo right now, and we know from the targeted neighborhood plan that Davis Park is a substantial recreational asset to the Mountain View neighborhood, and so it would be preferable to have a long-term solution to that, if possible.
Thank you, Mr. Cecil. You want to wrap up?
Yeah, I was just going to do that. So with that, I'll close. I do want to say that the planning department does applaud Mountain View neighborhood, and we encourage the adoption of the targeted neighborhood plan. Thank you.
Thank you. And are there are there still citations in code that talk about the conditions by which a secondary sponsor that's not the municipality can get a plan adopted? Are those conditions and criteria that we still evaluate here, and have you evaluated that? There's a provision in the old code that clearly laid out the process by which someone other than the municipality could sponsor a plan and a plan could get adopted, which is where all the conditions related to the land use plan map and all that stuff come in. Could I get that citation and some confirmation that that evaluation has taken place? And while you're looking for that, if there are no other questions, I'm going to open the public hearing and ask the petitioner to come forward. Everybody good? Okay, before I do so, the procedure by which the public may speak to the commission is after the staff presentation is completed on public hearing items, chair will ask for public testimony on the issue. Persons who wish to testify will follow the time limits established in the commission rules of procedures. Petitioners, including all of his or her representatives, get 10 minutes. Representatives of groups, community councils, PTAs, etc., 5 minutes, and individuals, 3 minutes. When your testimony is complete, you may be asked questions by the commission. You may only testify once on any issue unless questioned by the commission. An individual may have appeal rights relating to any action the Planning and Zoning Commission takes, except commission recommendations to the assembly, which are not appealable. This is one such case. So clearly, after our recommendation here, you move on to introduction and public hearing and action at the assembly. So with that, could the petitioner please come forward?
Good evening, members of the commission. For the record, my name is Daniel George, and I am the president of the Mountain View Community Council. I suppose that we could also be considered a petitioner, but so I guess that means we have 15 minutes, right? We're both president and...
You're part of the 10 right now, okay. Daniel.
All right. Well, without any further ado, the Mountain View Community Council adopted a resolution in 2012 which endorsed and authorized the Anchorage Community Land Trust to act as our agent in preparing this Mountain View Targeted Neighborhood Plan. That resolution was forwarded to the Assembly, which approved that request, and we have been working with the Anchorage Community Land Trust since the fall of 2012 in putting this plan together. I will note that we did not hire consultants. We did not have a large budget for this endeavor, as many other groups may have done in other community council areas, but we did have an ace in the hole. We had the Community Land Trust, and I want to say up front, I think they've done a fantastic job. So with that, I'll let Radhika introduce and talk a little bit about how we got here.
Great. Hi, everyone. I'm Radhika Krishna. I'm the Community Development Manager for the Anchorage Community Land Trust, and I'm also serving as the Secretary of the Mountain View Community Council right now. So I'm going to start with a little bit of history, not back in 1998 when our first neighborhood plan started, but in 2012 when we started this current iteration of the neighborhood planning process. So in 2012, the assembly chart allowed us to create a targeted neighborhood plan, which is what we've done over the subsequent 3 or 4 years. The Mountain View Community Council then chartered the Anchorage Community Land Trust, which is a neighborhood nonprofit working in Mountain View, with the planning process. In 2012, we kicked off this planning process by holding a Mountain View Community Summit at Clark Middle School. 150 Mountain View residents came together and they spent 2 days talking about their vision for Mountain View. They discussed what kind of community they wanted to live in, and they created a set of goals and action items that now is the core of this neighborhood plan. So when you look at the implementation matrix in Chapter 3, all of that was created directly by Mountain View residents working together to think of the ways that they could get their community from what Mountain View is today to the community they want it to be. Over the next 2 or 3 years now, we spent a lot of time talking to residents. I personally sat at the library and at the Red Apple and collected 125 surveys from Mountain View residents. We held focus groups with Clark Middle School students and rural CAP Homeward Bound residents and Mountain View business owners and social service providers in the neighborhood. And then last summer, after we had a draft of the plan, which we created with countless hours that the planning department helped us with, we had an open house for this plan. We had 300 people show up, and this was at the Mountain View Street Fair last year. So I think that we're very proud of the fact that we've gotten about 1,000 people in Mountain View, that's 1 in 7 of our residents, to be involved in this plan, to participate, and to show their support. So it really is a grassroots neighborhood plan, and now I'm going to turn it over to Daniel again.
Thank you. Touching a little further on all the efforts that have gone into this, I want to recognize we have some folks here that may not be prepared to testify but should be recognized. Jason Bookman is our council treasurer. Don Crandall is our former community council president. He was president from 2007 through 2012. At that time, I became president, and so we've got 9 continuous years of council leadership here advocating for this plan tonight. We've got Virginia McClure with the Mountain View Anchorage Library, Kirk Rose with the Anchorage Community Land Trust, and we had Representative Tarr here earlier. Unfortunately, she had to go back to Juneau. I guess they're still working down there. So And we've had a tremendous amount of help from the planning department. I want to thank their staff for spending so many hours with us over the last few years. This is not the first plan that Mountain View has undergone, but it is the first that has been wholeheartedly started from start to finish, supported by the council and been in constant contact with us. There have been probably at least half a dozen plans, and they're all elucidated in the plan, spelled out, you know, over time. Some focused on arts and culture districts, some focused on traffic. We looked at all of those when we were developing this plan. Mountain View, by nature, is a changing area. That has to do with the fact that a lot of folks that live there rent and do not own. The neighborhood has changed a lot over time, and so it's important that we look at the history of how it's changed, especially in the last decade, with the intense investment from groups like Cook Inlet Housing Authority, NeighborWorks, Rasmussen Foundation Community Land Trust. I could go on and on. The Municipality of Anchorage did wonderful capital improvements, rebuilding Clark Middle School. The state of Alaska put the highway overpass over the Berga Street there, which tied us directly in with the Russian Jack area. We had a $1 million street lighting grant from the state of Alaska, which makes it much more pedestrian friendly. We had the Glen Square Mall finally come to fruition. We had anchor tenants like Bass Pro Shops come in, providing jobs for folks in the area. So a lot of things have taken place even in the last few years that we started this planning effort. But the real value in this plan is not just understanding how far we've come, but spelling out what are our needs that remain and how do we get there. And accountability is a big part of this plan. In the implementation matrices, we talk about various goals, who's responsible for them, and what the length of time that we anticipate those goals will take. Of course, no plan has perfect foresight, and we understand this will have to be revisited from time to time. But there is a tremendous value in this plan to have a concerted effort as a neighborhood, as many of the agencies that work in the area can take it, can look at it, can see how they fit within the community's needs and how they can advocate to help create positive change in our neighborhood, whether that's through new programs, investment, advocating for infrastructure, or bringing businesses that provide working wage jobs to Mountain View, or whether it's the city of Anchorage providing adequate bus service or whatever the need may be. This plan serves a host of values for the community. And probably one of the highest values it does is it lists our top priorities. And the five highest priorities listed in the plan, or the going forward, our goals are improving Davis Park. And the planning department staff talked a little bit about the ownership issue with that park. I think we're looking at a positive solution here that may involve our congressional delegation. Increasing pedestrian amenities. We had a high rate of pedestrian and vehicle collisions, as well as bike collisions as well. They're noted in the plan. Adding new bus routes, paving the alleys, and encouraging reinvestment of blighted properties. We've seen progress in all of these areas in the last few years, but that's because we've identified them as our highest priorities consistently. And I think there's no better way to do that than through this Mountain View Neighborhood Plan.
Thank you for your presentation. Are there any questions, the petitioner? My question is, the department has the four recommendations that John went through. Do you have any issues with those recommendations in the staff packet? They're on page 4.
So we're talking about recommendations on page 4. Revise the land use plan map, fixing the color to match the, so it's more of a different color, so it's easily discernible. We think that's a good change.
Okay.
The half block between Meyer Street and Shoddy Street, north of Commercial Drive, this is a halfway vacant block already. It is, across the street from it, is a fairly modest to moderate industrial area already. There is one or two parcels on this stretch of block that are currently a business-zoned business, but that's, I don't think that's incompatible with long-term looking at making this fit within the overall industrial reserve, which is adjacent to it. There is not an alleyway that separates those homes from those parcels, so you wouldn't have any traffic, but you may end up with industrial abutting R4. That's the only concern that might come to light. However, I don't think we object to, you know, its continuity is already there with the industrial reserve.
Okay, and numbers 3 and the sort of deeper dive into the accident potential zone, okay with that?
So it's an excellent point about the APC. You know, it's there now. It might not always be there. We talked a little bit about the work session about this, but now we're in the formal hearing. It's important to go over a little bit of that again. If J-Bear had its way, there wouldn't be homes in this zone. That being said, it's important to protect the rights of existing property owners who purchased those homes or those properties with the current zoning. We're talking about, I think this is specific to the mixed-use corridor lots. Is that correct?
This number three is really the sort of circular quarter circle that takes the eastern corner of the neighborhood. So if I read this, presumably it would be added as some kind of action step or through their, we heard them say through the land use plan map process, that they'd somehow look at some, you know, I don't know what happens if that line cuts your lot in half or, you know, again, it's kind of how it gets looked at, but that they would proceed, and my guess is they're going to look at it anyway, but you have an opportunity to state what your preference is as the authors of this plan.
I think that this particular wording finds a good middle ground, and that it talks about exploring reducing the possible density without actually mandating it, and it talks about specifically the redevelopment rights for existing multifamily properties.
So could I suggest maybe one of my conditioners or fellow commissioners talk about explore with community input reducing the residential density? So if we put that, do you think that would make it okay?
I think that if you didn't have community support, I don't know that I could support that change.
Okay. So maybe redundant, but might be necessary. So with that, and then the fourth one is just I imagine you're okay with trying to get Davis Park locked up.
I've been working very hard at that.
Yes. Yeah. Okay. So with those four, are there any other questions of the petitioner? Okay. So I'd like to, anybody else wishing to testify here this evening? Don't go too far. No one's coming up? You waited all that time? Come on.
Hello. My name is Jason Bookman. As Daniel said, I'm not only a resident, but also the current treasurer of the community council member.
But you're speaking as a resident here.
I'm speaking as a resident, actually. B-O-O-K-M-A-N is my last name. And actually, my home is actually in that little circle that you were just speaking of. And actually, what I think that this program or this plan would be really nice is for those people who are moving forward in the community and considering the community, they'd be more publicized as to the impact and how that part of the safety zone that is needed for the Air Force is actually there. I purchased my home not knowing that, and now I get to hear the sounds of freedom about 300 feet above my head. So I think that having these kind of formal plans and looking at the input that is really broad-based in our neighborhood is really important to continue some of the momentum that a lot of people have put forward to developing our neighborhood into one of the leadership neighborhoods of the community of Anchorage, which is what I would like to see.
Thank you for your testimony.
Thank you.
Anybody else wishing to testify? Anybody at all? All right, Radhika and Daniel, anything else to add? It's okay to say no. All right, hearing none, the public hearing is closed. What's the wish of the body? Mitzi.
I guess I have to make the motion first, then I get a second. In the matter of case number 2016-0059, I move, make sure procedurally I do this right, that I'm moving that we recommend adoption of the Mountain View Targeted Neighborhood Plan by the Anchorage Assembly, incorporating the department recommendations 1, 2, 3, and 4 with a slight bit of wordsmithing to number 3. That would address intent of the municipality to explore along with the community and community council reducing the residential designation. No change to the rest of the paragraph.
Thank you, Ms. Barker. So is there a second? Thank you. There's a second for Ms. Bailey. Ms. Barker, would you like to speak to your motion?
Thank you. I find this very exciting and gratifying on a personal level. I started my career doing this kind of neighborhood planning, and I am thrilled to see it come back again. They're to be commended for doing a grassroots neighborhood plan that encompasses what you managed to do was to tie together the people and the land use in a cogent and cohesive way, that these things don't exist independently. You've done it in a very professional manner, and surely you are to be commended for doing such a fine job.
Thank you, Ms. Barker. Ms. Bailey.
Just for further findings, I do know that in this community is one of the most diverse, not only in Anchorage but in the world, and in those situations it's very hard to get representative public involvement, and I just want to applaud you all in going above and beyond and making sure that that was represented. And then just as a second point, just if Commissioner Barker is okay with it, I'd offer a friendly amendment to item number 2, what's labeled aircraft protection zone, where it's actually labeled as accident protection zone everywhere else. Just a cleanup measure.
Thank you, Ms. Bailey. Yeah, I don't think an amendment's needed. I'll ask that staff make that consistent. And thank you for your comments. Mr. Kange?
I would just like to add for the findings that the adoption of this targeted neighborhood plan is supported by public testimony.
Mr. Cecil, is there a particular citation?
Mr. Chairman, thank you. So code reference is 21.03.130, and that refers to neighborhood or district plans. And in this particular case, where the development of a neighborhood or district, neighborhood or district plan has been submitted by citizen groups that are approved by the Assembly, which has been indicated. The authority, the plan submittal, let's see, wait a minute, one, two. So the purpose, plan submittal, standards, and plan distribution and review have all been met by the applicant.
Thank you, Mr. Cecil. So I would add in my finding that 2103-130 neighborhood or district plan adoption have been satisfied. I think this plan is an extension, a further extension of Anchorage 2020, and in the spirit of refining at a closer level what it means to look at planning in Anchorage. And I would further add that if there should be a discrepancy between this plan and other functional plans, that this plan shall be, at least as long as other plans are not updated, shall be deemed to be the guiding document. With that, I ask the commissioners please vote. That failed. No, I'm just kidding. Congratulations.
I would add, until that last public testimony, I was on the edge. I didn't know how it was going to go.
Thank you, everybody. Could I get a motion to adjourn, please? Thank you, Mr. Walker. He is fast. We're adjourned.